as Jagr cut to the front of the net. Dominik Hasek tried to stick check him, missed him, and just threw his pads out and made an incredible save.
Welcome, everybody, to episode 92 of Two Goalies, One Mic. I am Wayne from Two Goalies, One Mic. And looks like somebody's screaming.
Gatesy has gone out on us.
Somebody needs to screenshot this right now. Hold on. This has to happen. Hold on.
Is that the Sabres look over the last 15 years? Like.
Hold on.
Jesus.
Yeah, that's going on a shirt.
100%. This is fantastic. Hold on. Capture entire screen. Capture. Without a doubt, that is unbelievable. I'm going to take him.
Poor Gatesy.
Jeez.
Oh, Gatesy.
Tough start.
Yeah,
there he is. He's there.
School Wi-Fi decided to really just cut it out right as we're starting. So
that was fantastic.
Find a new location.
Always blame the equipment. That's a veteran.
Yeah, 100%.
Yeah. If it wasn't the Wi-Fi, it was also my computer. It was not me.
That's good. God, that was fantastic. Anyways, guys, I'm excited for today. The NHL trade deadline is less than 2 hours away. Haven't heard, unless anything's happened in the last 10 minutes that I haven't seen, Buffalo's been really quiet, but. The only Buffalo news we have to offer is that the Bills just, signed Duke Johnson, an unbelievable pass catching running back. So that's cool. But other than that, that's the only Buffalo news outside of the Robert Hagg, trade for a 6th round pick yesterday. But already to start the morning, there's been a lot of action. Obviously leading the headline was the Marc-Andre Fleury trade to the Minnesota Wild for a conditional 2nd round pick. Anyone can hop in.
Again, I think, the Sabres, these late deadlines, they're going to get something done, I hope. There's been stuff going on around the league that's exciting for the playoffs. Teams are building up. I think it's interesting now is obviously the retaining of salary. The interesting stuff, the long-term IR. I mean, you're seeing guys go on IR conveniently. And they get advantage of that system now. And it makes the playoffs more intriguing. You look at Tampa winning it the last 2 years and the Kucherov stuff, and is that a formula that GMs are trying to get into? It's interesting to make salary cap room and how that stuff works. I mean, again, I don't know the ins and outs, but it makes for people like the sport and makes for people hate some teams during the playoffs. So I think it makes hockey more entertaining for playoff runs here.
Agreed. Yeah. How are you feeling about today, Ryan?
Well, today, obviously, it's been a little quiet outside of the big noise around Marc-Andre Fleury, of course, and we'll dig into that. I mean, obviously, it really improves Minnesota's chances. And, I mean, this year, they really have to go for it because of cap ramifications from the Parise and Suter deals that are going to start affecting them to the tune of almost $14 million next year in dead cap, which, I mean, we'll get into that later, too, because I really don't agree with that system. It's funny you bring up the LTIR thing, Quickie. I was talking about this with Craig Button at the ring the other night. Someone in the NHL,
a big deal.
Yeah, he's the prospect guy. Someone in the NHL told me this a few years ago, because obviously the number one team you think of when you say LTIR, it's Tampa Bay. And it's funny because everybody hates on Tampa for this system. Of course, Kucherov last year, they add all these guys. You'll remember in 2015 they lost in the Stanley Cup final to the Chicago Blackhawks. And Tampa was kind of looked at as an up-and-coming team. Then they still had Ben Bishop. Vasilevsky was not the starting goalie on that team. And that year, Patrick Kane got hurt, and he didn't come back until game one of the playoffs. And that allowed Chicago to acquire Anton Vermette and a couple other pieces.
That, yeah.
That summer, in the GM's meetings, Tampa Bay raised that as an issue. They said, hey, are we all okay with this whole thing going on that Chicago managed to do? And they put on the table essentially a proposal to not allow teams to do that over, I was told, over a certain number. Of course, Patrick Kane's cap hit like $10 million, right?
Yeah.
So they proposed a system where you couldn't stash and then use more than, I think it was about $3 million on LTIR in terms of adding to your team. And all the other GMs voted no. And so Tampa kept that in their back pocket. And they said, okay, you know what? If you're going to do it, we're going to do it. And so it's funny that now everyone's like, oh, Tampa, they're evil. They do this. They wanted to get rid of this, and everyone else said no. So fair game in my eyes.
Oh, 100%. And again, I think it's a ploy that these guys are using now to obviously deepen their teams and, you know, get certain spots, obviously retaining stuff, not retaining, but it makes it interesting to see then when those cap numbers come up in the playoffs and you're like, well, you know, it again, until it's addressed in the next whatever NHLPA, it's fair game. It's fair game. It is what it is. It's the rules. So
I think the only one I haven't had a problem with is the Aaron Ekblad. We all know he did get hurt. So, I mean, unfortunately, that team was already possibly the deepest, in my opinion, the scariest team heading into the playoffs, especially after adding Giroux.
True.
And then Ben Chiarot out of Montreal. And then you go in and you free up that much cap space going into the playoffs with an LTIR on Aaron Ekblad, a guy who has been an anchor for them, possibly part of the best defensive pairing in the league. And now you just have that much more money to work with, either to get more I heard rumors that they want stability in net. I don't know what more Actually, I shouldn't say that because Bob has not been that great in the playoffs in the past. So that is a possibility. They'd be looking in net to maybe try and bring a more, you know, a stable third goalie into the mix in case there is an injury, or maybe just some more offensive power to their bottom six. I don't know, but that'll be interesting to watch. And then again, we're still sitting on our hands waiting for Kevin Adams to make a move.
Yeah. And guys, I don't know if I've taken too many pucks to the head the past couple of years, but I cannot figure out the trade market for the life. I mean, everyone's getting different deals for the same player. And I'm really interested to see what Kevin Adams does with someone like Colin Miller. You've seen other defensemen kind of go for kind of a wide range of prices these past couple of days. And I don't know, Ryan, if you have any idea of what you think Miller will go for.
I mean, Buffalo, obviously, I think one thing that they would really like to address is shoring up their defense. Obviously, they've tried a number of different things there over the years. They got rid of Rasmus Ristolainen, and I actually think they did well there because you look at his underlying numbers and they just aren't great and he didn't work out in the end. I think that they would really like to find a permanent partner to play with Dahlin, who's really come alive the last few weeks. Like I think that he is still the number one guy that you can build around. He's not, you know, regressed in terms of his talent level. He's just had ups and downs. Defense, like, it's the hardest position in the NHL, in my opinion, to walk in and perform well at. There's so much you're responsible for now as a defenseman with his skill set. So I think that if they can try and target somebody who can be a consistent veteran guy to pair with him and really fill out the bottom pair of that decor as well to start to try and build to being more competitive next year, that would, in my eyes, probably be the number one thing that they look at. Would they look at the goalie market? Probably not right now, given that I don't think there's anybody available anymore that it would make sense, A, for Buffalo to acquire, because they're not going to make the playoffs, and two, there's not a lot of guys out there with a lot of term on their deals that they could retain and pair in the future with an Ukko-Pekka Luukkonen. So, you know, I think the decor is something that they're really going to try and address. And maybe, you know, they would really love a third line center as well. Like Casey Mittelstadt, is he going to be a permanent NHL center? I don't think so. I think he might be better suited at the wing. So certainly some positions that Buffalo are going to look at.
I will say this about Casey, though. Even if he's not fit for playing up the middle, I think, and I don't like giving this guy credit at all, like at all, because he was possibly the worst hire in the history of this organization. I will say his defensive game, his 200-foot game, did improve under Ralph Kruger and did show you know, at the end of last season under Don Granato. And, you know, you've seen a little bit here when he's gotten healthy in Buffalo. So I am pleased to see the fact that his game as a whole, 200 feet in the defensive, neutral, and offensive zone. Casey's game has improved in that aspect. Has the offense necessarily been there? No. Well, he also hasn't been healthy. So, but regardless if they decide to keep him on the wing or keep him at center or put him on the wing, you know, I am pleased to see that, you know, in his own end, he has put a lot more effort and taken more pride in his responsibilities defensively.
I kind of agree with that. It's been, especially last night, that Vancouver game for not only Casey, but Dahlin, they both kind of took big strides and almost kind of quieting the Buffalo faithful have kind of been anti those two the past year or so with kind of their play, especially in their own end. And last night they were both kind of rewarded on the score sheet, which is, I think, really big for this team that someone other than like Tage Thompson, Alex Tuck are getting on the scoreboard. I think that's really important for this team.
Yeah.
100% agree. And, speaking of that game last night, I think, you know, 2 months ago, I tweeted it out last night after they won that game in overtime. 2 months ago, this team, you know, I mean, not this team, this fan base was really hard on Rasmus Dahlin. You know, he was taking a lot of shots either on Twitter or on any other social media platform, in the media, you know, got on other podcasts, taking shots at him, saying that, you know, he isn't nearly what he's supposed to be. He's a first overall pick. And you see guys like Cale Makar who perform so well, Miro Heiskanen, and just to name a couple names, Quinn Hughes, guys that maybe aren't necessarily taken first overall, but were performing at a higher level than Dahlin. But those guys are also surrounded by a much better team. And I've always been a Dahlin defender through and through. I said, this kid came into the league. He was barely 18 years old. He's still barely legally to even drink here in the United States. And this organization, this fan base has been so hard on him. And I understand you have high expectations for the kid, but you know, Kyle, you could speak to this. How much more time does it take for a defenseman to develop more than, say, a winger or a center?
Yeah, I think for him, like, you know, you're talking development, you're talking coaching changes, you're talking a lot of different things, defensive pair, no stability. Like, for a defenseman, those are big things for development. And, you know, he may have all the tools in the tool shed, but you also need someone to teach him how to use those tools. Over time, I don't think like a simple thing as stick placement in, you know, Sweden versus the NHL is a big deal. And, you know, again, has he been taught that? Well, in Sweden, he was an offensive defenseman and, you know, he was all over the ice. He could skate, you know, those were his tools. Well, he shows he can use those, but you need a stable partner. Again, I was talking with Rivs about it in terms of, you know, even Tyler Myers had Ludman and who's the other guy? Talinder, you know, like stability for a young kid to actually be able to use his tools, but, you know, get advanced on tools that he needs to work on. And those things, again, you know, over time, they will get better. But you need stability there to actually help that. But, and again, you credit him for going through this and, you know, he's a kid, so he's obviously plugged into social media. So he sees all this stuff of people, you know, chirping him and all this stuff, and he's still progressing. That says a lot about him. But again, like learning stick placement as an offensive defenseman, we were talking about Merkley before it, you know, it's something that over time you get better at, but it takes time and stability. And he hasn't had that. So how can you blame a kid like that? You can't. I mean, he's using his tool set, what he has, to be as good as he can. But you got to be able to teach him his tool set within the surroundings that he has. And he hasn't had good surroundings. So
no, he's on his third head coach in, what, 4 years? Like, how can you – I guess you could say the same thing about Jack when he was here. Like, you have such instability, and it was just, you know, a turntable at key positions in this league that, you know, don't involve playing on the ice and between GM and coach. And how can you expect guys to develop properly when you're going year to year, you're learning a new system, you're learning a new coach, you're learning, you know, a new attitude and culture. And there's been a lack of a culture in Buffalo for a decade. And now you're finally starting to see that. And one thing I wanted to touch too, before we continue, was, you know, One of the things that stuck out to me last night were the post-game comments from Casey Mittelstadt and Rasmus Dahlin. Casey Mittelstadt, when asked about Dahlin, he's one of my best friends. You know, this guy's elite. You know, he was saying we're a family. And it's been hard to hear stuff like that from any Buffalo Sabres player for the past decade. It's been a long time. I'd say the closest thing we've had to that was back when we still had like Marcus Foligno and Drew Stafford, players like that, guys who did stick up for each other. Mm-hmm. But I'm on a line to say since that whole, you know, Milan Lucic, Ryan Miller debacle, like slowly declined culture wise in Buffalo. Yeah. And it just had this like really long lasting effect. And I know I might be stupid for saying that, but it just feels like it. But here's one of the things that Dahlin said after the game. We'll play the video of the goal too, but right here, this is just a small example of how the culture has shifted here in Buffalo.
Well, I can start with the overtime goal. How'd you see it develop?
It always feels like when you whiff on a shot, you always score, so I was kind of lucky, but great play from Taki, just holding it, and then gave me a perfect play there, so it was fun. It was good.
Casey, it seemed like you had one in you all night. Did you feel particularly well tonight?
Yeah, I was kind of feeling it today, to be honest. But it just happened that we got the win. It was a hell of a game from us. We battled through the whole 60 and a little bit more. So that one felt really good.
What's it mean for the group to end the road? I mean, back-to-back overtime wins against two teams that are really pushing for playoff spots. What does it mean to the group?
A lot. You can really see we're in every game. We have close games against the best teams in the league, so it's great for us. Gives us a boost, and now we can really start to become a really good hockey team.
How big was Andy for you guys tonight in goal?
Oh, huge. You always have a great feeling when he's back in our net, you know. So calm, and, you know, if you make a play, he's just telling us to calm down or whatever, but he's a hell of a goalie.
A couple of real tight games for a large portion of the game. How is the group responding, I guess, in those tight moments right now?
Yeah, exactly. That's a big difference. You really see, you know, Cuzzy's always in there, and we're protecting each other. We're not backing down anymore. We love to compete, and we never give up.
They had a big push in the third period, to be expected, you know, they're in a desperate spot. So what allowed you guys to sort of hold them off there?
I
mean, those last comments right there when he's talking about Cousins and just being in games and not giving up ever, you know, those times are over. We don't give up on each other anymore. I think that really speaks to that culture shift we spoke about before, because it's been a long time since we've seen or heard comments from any player in this organization like that.
Yeah, I don't know if you guys saw that Sabres embedded video of the four of them going curling. I think it was Skinner, Thompson, Krabs, and maybe Tuck, but those four guys together, like, it was so natural. They had such a great time together, and you can just tell us how close this young group is, and that's something that this organization hasn't had in 10 years. That stability of knowing that they're going to be there, and they want to have a better future, not only for themselves, but the city of Buffalo as a whole.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, there's something to be said for that, right? And, like, that is step one. And it's a step that the Sabres, and you guys would know better than me watching them a lot more than I do, they just have not had that. They've had little flashes of it over the last 10 years and a little bit during the time when Jack was still on the team. But that literally is step one. You've got to get everybody wanting to be a family. You got to get everybody wanting to win together. It's one thing to assemble talent. Assembling talent, it, essentially, in the grand scheme of things, is easy. You get draft picks every year. You draft young players. All of them are talented. You know, everybody that gets drafted into the NHL is talented in some regard. That's the easy part. Look what's going on in Toronto right now. And I know Dwayne will love that. You love to bag on the Leafs. They've got all the talent in the world. How has it worked out for them so far? And I'm not trying to say that core of guys doesn't like each other, whatever, but step one is getting everybody to want to win together. And that might sound weird, like, well, it's sports, of course you want to win. That's not necessarily true all the time. Building a group of 22 guys in a room that all want to pull on the rope together for each other, that's hard. And you need the right general manager in place. You need the right scouting staff in place to supplement that every year with your draft picks. And bigger than that, you need the right coaching staff. And Donnie Meatballs certainly looks like the right type of guy for this group. He understands these young guys. And I completely agree with you. I mean, it's really positive to hear that type of stuff from a guy like Rasmus Dahlin, who, if Buffalo ends up going anywhere in the next few years in terms of improvement, he's going to be probably the central figure in that, along with guys like Cousins, who I think has really done a lot for the morale in that room. The workhorse from Whitehorse, he is a guy that you can build around, and it's really positive to see.
Yeah, I think, again, you're talking culture, and obviously, you know, the city of Buffalo, the biggest thing is, you know, with the Bills, the culture. And now you're starting to see the Sabres turn that, you know, corner of culture. At every level, it's important to have that family sense to win. You know, you can get yourself, you know, to a certain spot without actually being a close group because of talent at certain levels. But if you really want to win, you know, the biggest thing these guys talk about is the room, the culture, the family, at any level, you know, and those are biggest things going into the playoffs. It's what, you know, obviously teams get hot, but at the end of the day, you know, when a team wins the cup, it's about, you know, the culture, the family. Everyone was a close group. That's what all they talk about. It has nothing to do with, oh, well, you know, Pat Kane was a stud this day. It's, no one ever talks about that, especially in hockey. It's about how close the group was. And now you're starting to see that, you know, with it being a young group. And it's interesting to talk about Granato, and, you know, everyone was bagging him, you know, probably 2 months ago, same thing, you know. And again, like, he's coming from a different level before. He's, you know, he's come up, he's learned, he's been with the national program, he's been with younger kids. Now he's got a younger type of room where he may be the right guy because of that. You know, he's understanding this generation of players, where it's a little different than bringing in a coach in the NHL who's been in the NHL for 10 years, but he's also had an older group where, you know, you get these young kids coming in. It's a different type of message to get them to come together. It's not always, you know, do this, do that. You have to convey your message differently. And maybe he's figured that out with this group, and that's why they're becoming it, you know, the family that they are.
Yeah. Before we continue on, obviously we're finally joined by Mr. Kid Cully, fresh out of getting his oil changed late, you know, texting me, losing his mind. I'll be there. Just pulled in, giving me the play-by-play of his day so far today, on his way to getting on the podcast. So here he is. Kid Cully himself,
oh boy,
Johnny Cullen, and we can't even hear him. So we'll let him get his mic. We'll let him get his mic, you know, ready first before we bring him in.
God, but, can he get rid of all that Windsor stuff while he's at it?
Yeah, I know he can't get rid of Windsor. Brian, he pre-warned me not to give him shit. You know, him knowing that you do play-by-play for the Guelph Storm, He's probably going to talk a lot about his OHL career today. You know, give himself a few pats on the back. So
that's okay. That's perfectly fine, man. Hey, yeah, pump your own tires. You got to.
Every day. Oh, you don't have to tell him to pump his own.
Oh, no, you get him going, he'll go. Don't do that.
He'll go. One thing too, though. Obviously, I want to replay that. I want to play that goal from last night from Dahlin before we start doing our trade grades and reacting to some of the bigger deals like Marc-Andre Fleury, Claude Giroux, etc. Here's the goal from Dahlin, where I really think like he was due for something like this was bound to happen with the way he played last night. You know, hashtag Sabres after dark. This goal just really amplifies the type of player he is and he's capable of being. And I really don't think we've reached the tip of the iceberg that is Rasmus Dahlin.
Fans want the 3-on-3 excitement we were promised. Here's Dahlin, and drops for Tuck. Cuts across the slot. Alex Tuck, shadowed by Hughes. Drops off. Dahlin cuts in front. He shoots. He scores. Rasmus Dahlin. I'm not sure the Canucks ever touched the puck. And the Sabres, 48 seconds into overtime, win it. 3-2 the final at Rogers Arena.
Well, not very often you see a guy just out for faceoff duty on 3-on-3. And that was Cody Eakin out for faceoff duty. And they, as you say, the Sabres had control from that time on. Circle around Dahlin, who has been very good in this game, cuts the middle, just lets it go, and right through Thatcher Demko. Oh, Horvat tried to get a stick on it, couldn't. And Dahlin, who had a very good.
You know, Demko's rattled about that one. I can tell you.
Oh, 100%. And he even said, Dahlin even said that he whiffed on that shot. Yeah. He meant to go bar down. He actually go five hole. Hopefully, we finally got Kid Cully ready to go. Cully, can you hear us?
Yes.
There we go.
How about Kyle?
There he is. He's in. Yeah, but it's funny with like Demko guys, you know, again, I got to meet him when I was at Brown at, it was a BC Florida State tailgate. And he was like a young, he was probably 17 at the time. He was really young in college's freshman year. And the BC kids, Hayes and Gaudreau, were around and they're talking about like him on, and you see him in that reaction, him in practice. He would literally do what Hasek did, and like every puck that went in, he would put on the top of the net. You know, so you see that. And again, I know we're talking
about his interview on Spit and Chicklets. It just touches to your point, Quickie. He was extremely competitive, and to kind of come from this unknown kid from San Diego, or wherever he was in San Diego.
Yeah.
Like we always, me and you always talked about it. It takes, you have to be, you know, the best that you can possibly be, but a lot of things have to go right. And for him to sneak into the USHL when he did and kind of get, I don't want to say blackballed by the program, but to not have that happen, but then have another door open at BC that ultimately led to where he is now, right? Like, you only have that happen if you're extremely competitive.
Yeah,
I shouldn't say that, but it works for him.
Yeah, it works for him.
I personally, I don't mind seeing it if it's at the end of a game. You don't want to do it in the middle of the game like I used to do when your dad used to scream at me, because it's just allowing the other team, hey, you know, we're in this guy's head. And Ryan, I want to say hello. Nice to meet you. I don't know if you were there when I played, but it felt like every year I got Guelph's teddy bear toss game. So I, you know.
So that was in the first 10 seconds of the game then.
No, I had one shutout going in the last minute. And who was it? Damn it, Kyle. Me and you played against him. Taylor Beck. You remember him?
Daughter of Leck, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. He came down and across just like Dahlin did, a little weak side cut across, and Cully got smoked. So not a big
but
deal.
But turning it back to Dahlin, sorry I changed that subject there. Dahlin, I mean, again, like I think, you know, those are the types of goals that get you going, kind of those like goals where you're like, oh, I fanned on it, but it went in. Like your confidence just goes through the roof. Like, see how excited he was when he scored. You know, and again, those are things that like as a player, you know. Like, you know, you forget about all the crap in the past because, you know, your things start going your way. So it's good to see that for him. I mean, you know, it's definitely going to turn it. And, you know, again, this team is turning. You know, it's actually really nice to see. You actually want to watch games now. So
yeah, I've noticed it ever since the Leafs game. Dwayne and I talked about it, but like you're starting to see that energy build up. Hey, Gatesy, what's up? I didn't even see you down there, you little beauty.
Hey, Cully, how are you?
Good to see you again. no, but Kyle, like, you see, and Ryan, you see this life and this attitude around the Sabres that we haven't seen since, I don't know, let's say 2008, right? Where, you know, not only you have a young group, but they're playing for fun and they're getting points, right? Like, I don't want to put it all on goaltending and say magically be in a playoff spot. You don't quick start or restart, you know, or a rebuild. It has to happen the way it has to happen. But to see the life and the reinvigoration of Dahlin, I was worried for a bit, you know, like there was times over the past couple of years where you wondered, hey, like, is this the same guy that we saw clips of just absolutely undressing people in the World Juniors? Is he the generational talent that we thought he was at one? And I think he'll be fine. It's just to your point, Quickie, I think it's fun to see him, you know, start to have that success. And to your point about that shot coming off his stick, those are extreme, and Gatesy can touch on this. Those are extremely hard to read, especially in tight.
Why can't I tell you about that? Why has it got to be Gatesy? I'm a goalie too. What
I said Gatesy and Dwayne. Fuck off.
Okay. I thought I heard just heard Gatesy. That's cool though.
Hostility in here. Jesus.
Yeah. Dwayne. Let me see one of those. Yeah, it's I know Cully. I think you see me letting more than my fair share of goals that seem to go right through the chest protector over our time together. So
yeah, it's one where you try to be on top of it and then you make the right read and then it comes off the stick funny and then we look like the idiot, right? And yeah. Kyle has scored probably 1,000 of those, little asshole he is, getting to the slot.
Still doing them on you, clearly.
That's two overtime games and two interesting goals for the Sabres scored. The first one, Markstrom just complete whiffing that pass, and then last night going right through Demko. It's, you know, it's nice for the Sabres to kind of get some things going their way for once.
Yeah, it felt like forever. I know that you guys have probably touched on it, but Ryan, I wanted to ask how what's it been like covering the OHL this year? I'm not jealous of what they've had to go through. I never had anything like this while I was up there. Are you guys in a brief pause right now? What's the situation going on in Guelph?
Well, right now, like, luckily it's full steam ahead. We did have that, you know, unfortunate lockdown again just after the Christmas break where we almost went a full month without, you know, any games. And there was some concern that we would probably have to shave some games off of the regular 68 schedule, but the league got back in time in January to kind of extend the season. So they're going to go an extra 2 weeks right till April 17th. Everybody's going to play 68 and the league's rocking and rolling right now. Everybody's playing. We haven't had any games postponed in a couple weeks here. There was a little scare in Barrie recently, but other than that, I mean, from Guelph's perspective, everything's full steam ahead right now. Last week we got fans first full sellout of the season. Yes. On Wednesday against London, big storm win in a shootout. Yeah, it's great. What a difference it's been from calling games in a ghost town with literally no one in the arena in November. You know, where I'm sure the players could probably hear us. I mean, like echoing. It was just bizarre. Goal horns going off with nobody in there. And to see that sellout on Wednesday and know, hey, it finally feels like we're back. It's been positive.
So I got to work for the year after I retired. I did play-by-play for Kojiko intermissions for the road games for Kojiko, and then play-by-play with Ryan McLeod in Windsor, who's a hell of a guy. I think he's still doing it. He does local radio down there, I think in Chatham. But it's a tight-knit community of the play-by-play media guys, everybody that's involved in the day-to-day stuff. And the OHL is a fun league to be a part of that. What's your favorite rink away from home? I loved playing in London, hated playing in Owen Sound. So I guess my question to you is favorite and least favorite.
Well, yeah, it's interesting, right? Because being on the TV side of things, we don't travel on the road. The radio crews are really the only ones to go on the road. But I've been to every OHL rink at least one time. So, I mean, I can definitely comment on it. Man, I love the Odd. Like, it's just such an old, historic barn. Like, there's just something about the Odd in Kitchener. Like, you feel the history of the league and that team. They love the Rangers there. There's a fan group that has part ownership of the team.
Love that. Like the league has that, right?
That's right. It really feels like the Rangers belong to Kitchener, right? And on a really deep level. And the Odd, it's just those old school, real steep seats. The fans are right on top of you when they're selling out. And I mean, they're having a tough year this year, but when you've got like 7,100 people in there and it's a playoff game, it is bumping. There's no louder building. I loved London too. It's just a beautiful rink. Owen Sound. Yeah. As a broadcaster, and I do fill in duty for them. Sometimes I love the team. Everybody involved with the team's great. Dale DeGray's always been a great GM to deal with. But from a broadcasting sense, they've got that old school, I call it the birdcage broadcasting, where it's that old school thing hanging over. Right, you're in like, you. You're, it's this wide and you're just kind of crammed in there looking over the ice. It's very old school.
Coley, how'd you fit in there then?
Buddy, I did not. Joey Hishon and Garrett Wilson had their way with me, but I did get to mess with, Jordan Binnington. Because he wasn't the starter, and this was before I supplanted Jack Campbell. So the way the benches are set up, I was right next to Binnington. So I would give him the water bottle every whistle, every time the refs weren't looking. And he had the biggest snout ever. So I would just chirp his nose and his sister. There's no love lost between me and Binnington, I'll tell you that for free. Kyle, quick transition to you. If you hadn't been drafted to the Sarnia Sting, who play out of the Sarnia Library, and I can say that because I played for him, and I have no problem saying it. Kyle, if somebody like Kitchener or London would have grabbed you, would that have changed your path, do you think? Or were you set in stone?
No, I went up to camp in Sarnia. I considered it, obviously, like after my junior year, I went up. Again, it's hindsight. I don't know. I mean, again, I had, you know, so many injuries from 19 to 23 that it probably wouldn't have gone well. I don't think my body was physically ready for it. You know, but again, I mean, it's a different type of league than college. It's, you know, it's a little younger. I don't know. I think team wise, I mean, honestly, the funniest thing that happened during that thing is I played in the OHL Cup that year and did really well in it.
I remember that. But you're speaking modestly. You killed it that week.
Yeah, I did really well that week, but my phone, this is a true story. My phone at Salisbury wasn't getting reception. So, like, I was getting calls. I know Foligno was – I think he was Sudbury's GM at the time. Sudbury. And, like, they were all going to voicemail. And I think I went off campus the following week. And I was like, oh, like, I'm getting calls. Yeah, like, I'm getting calls that obviously I'm not returning.
Pete DeBoer just called me from Kitchener. Just called me from Windsor. What do I do?
Yeah, like, I mean, honestly, that may have changed some things. But again, I'm really happy with the route I took with college. I mean, obviously the, you know, Brown is, I mean, school itself was awesome. Even having three surgeries in 4 years. Ivy League
education, brother.
Yeah. Somehow getting the degree out of the Ivy League is good. But I just, you know, it probably would have, you know, you would have contemplated, but the thing is Sarnia did take me and my brother back-to-back picks that year, which I don't know if it's ever happened. Like, you know, obviously Kevin was already drafted in the NHL at that time too. So, you know, I don't know. It was pretty bizarre. So
that must have been a whirlwind day. I wanted to get that in before we got back to trade deadline. I was pulling in, or no, maybe just getting into my car when I heard about the Marc-Andre Fleury trade. Have you guys addressed that yet, Dwayne?
We were about to get right into that amongst other trades. Like as we've been talking, other trades have been breaking on the trade tracker. So just to give a quick before, I don't know if this is exactly updated, you know, per every couple minutes. Yeah. But so far today, this is what we got. Biggest trade leading off the day was Marc-Andre Fleury, which was teased yesterday from a few of the insiders, Michael Russo to be specific. Marc-Andre Fleury on his way to Minnesota for a conditional second round pick. It'll turn into a first if they make the Western Conference Finals and Fleury contributes to four of those wins, which is, you know, some weird you know, stipulations. Kaapo Kakkonen, goalie from Minnesota Wild, and a fifth round pick to San Jose for defenseman Jacob Middleton.
Do you remember him, Kyle?
No.
Ryan, do you remember him? He played what did he play for? Ottawa? He was a 67s
player. Yes, yes.
He wasn't very good. And I mean, I shouldn't say he wasn't very good. I just never pegged him to be in the league this long. Yeah, wow, what a pick. For Kaapo Kakkonen and a fifth to get Jacob Middleton. I mean, is that Billy Guerin, Dwayne? Is that Billy Guerin just trying to get some meat like the way that DeLaurier was picked up?
I think so.
DeLaurier
was
Minnesota.
Yeah, Minnesota.
They got both of them. No. Sorry, my bad. Sorry.
Yeah, DeLaurier was Minnesota, and you know, I mentioned yesterday during my quick recap of the trade deadline yesterday. Like DeLaurier is the type of guy that you know, he's not going to really give you much offensively, but he's a bottom six guy that's going to give you a lot of jam, a lot of grit. He's tough to play against, and he keeps you on your toes when you're out there. He can hit, he can skate, he can fight. Again, he's not going to contribute a ton offensively, but again, a guy that, you know, guys like that are important during playoff hockey. You look at a guy like Pat Maroon, who's got three cups in a row between St. Louis and the Tampa Bay Lightning. He's not necessarily an offensive threat, but, you know, he brings a different dynamic out there.
Well, one of the most effective lines in playoffs and over the last couple of years, and you like seeing this, is that Cizikas Clutterbuck combo line.
Yeah,
you know, those guys over the last couple of years in playoffs, you know, you turn a game on and those guys are the ones that in tight games are creating some space. So, you know, again, it, these teams, you know, I think when we had, when you guys had Cam on, you know, we were talking about that, those roles and how important they are when you get to this time. And it's going to be really interesting to see for sure what happens here. You know,
Brett Kulak, dealt to the, Edmonton Oilers for defenseman William Lagesson. Also Frederick Ellard, defenseman, dealt to the LA Kings for Braden Burke, a left winger. And then another bigger trade, was defenseman Justin Braun to the Rangers for, Philly, and Philly gets a 2023 third round pick. And then we have a future considerations deal. Nashville gets a, Alex Biega, defenseman, for future considerations. That's obviously probably some cap relief.
Salisbury alum.
It's not a big deal.
Yeah. And then we already went over the Jacob Middleton. But like I said, that Marc-Andre Fleury trade, it's kind of wild that you go from winning the Vezina Trophy in 2021, and since then you're on your second team in a year. You know, at least this time they told him he was being traded, whereas in Vegas, you know, he had to find out on Twitter.
Yeah, for sure. It's I'm sure Marc-Andre Fleury probably feels, you know, some sense of relief. I know that the, you know, the dominating narrative this year was that he really didn't want to have to move his family again. And maybe he won't. Maybe they'll stay behind in Chicago. Who knows? And, you know, we are talking about a 38-year-old goalie who, you know, will play as long as he feels like. Someone will always find room for a guy like that with his pedigree. But I'm sure he's probably relieved in some sense to get away from a lot of negative noise in Chicago. The team's just not very good. This is something that he has not dealt with professionally, on a competitive level since the early days of the rebuild in Pittsburgh when they were bad, 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 right? So I think that he's probably relieved to be going to a team in Minnesota that, you know, I don't think people talk about them necessarily as an A-grade contender. Acquiring Marc-Andre Fleury might push them into that conversation. Do I think that they're better right now, even with Marc-Andre Fleury, than Calgary or Colorado? No, but give them credit, man. They're pushing their chips right into the middle of the table.
Yeah.
I've been a big fan of what Bill Guerin's done with several moves he's made. And to hear him talk about how he's gone about it, like, it wasn't so long ago that we talked about, you know, the big moves of Parise and Suter, and I know they're still like paying off those contracts, but like they played a boring brand of hockey, or they never really had a lot of life. And considering where they are in the U.S. market, right? Like, I would say it goes maybe like Massachusetts, Minnesota, Michigan. And then maybe New York falls into that fourth place spot. But, like, they call it what? The state of hockey? Like, they deserve a winner. And you could say that for Buffalo. You could say that for anybody. I know that's kind of cliche, but I'm excited to see what Minnesota can do. But like you talked about a little bit, Ryan, like, that's the tough Western Conference to get through, right? It'll be really interesting to see how the standings shake out. And especially with a team like Edmonton that's in that, you know, we're talking about, I think, are they still in the wild card, Edmonton, right? Like, we're talking about the best player in the world and maybe, you know, another of the top five,
yeah.
If they can find their stream, and who knows, maybe they can pull off a trade here and get some help. I don't know, but they seem to have been playing a lot better hockey now that they've gotten healthy, have gotten that depth back. It's going to be crazy to see what unfolds in the Western Conference.
I couldn't agree more. Just per Emily Kaplan, the Anaheim Ducks are shopping Ricard Raquel. Boston and Vegas believed to be interested. The Rangers were also involved at some point. Another bigger name possibly coming off the trade bait board. Not surprisingly, after they dealt Josh Manson to, I think, who did Manson go to? Was it the Avalanche?
Yeah, Manson went to Colorado.
Yep, yep. So not surprising that they're selling here. You know, probably, you know, obviously they might have a ton of faith in themselves that they're going to be a playoff contender. So they're trying to get as many assets as they can. But another name to look out for, I believe he's a UFA. A guy that can definitely add another dynamic offensively to your team if you happen to pick him up. And interesting to see Vegas involved. I know they've been struggling. They're really in danger of not making the playoffs. But do they even remotely have the cat? I'm not sure what his
cat is. I think Pacioretty just won an LTIR today.
Okay, that makes sense. There's your cap space. There's your cap space.
Yeah, there's your cap space, guys. We're opening up.
Quick question for you guys, a quick poll. Does this loophole that Tampa Bay exploited last year and that other teams are exploiting, maybe loophole's not the right word, does this long-term, you know, injured reserve cap space and then, you know, obviously cap doesn't count in playoffs, does this get addressed and fixed or changed at the next GM meetings this summer?
It's funny you say that because, like, we talked about this and I told the story about how in 2015 when the Lightning lost to Chicago and they originally did this with Patrick Kane, allowing them to acquire Anton Vermette on the way to a cup, Tampa brought this up at the GM meetings that year in the summer of 2015 and said, is this the type of thing that we want to allow? And they had a proposal on the table to basically not allow a certain gaudy number of cap to be stored on LTIR. And the other GMs voted no. So I don't think that the GMs, I bet you the owners probably would be in agreement with this because it would save them money in terms of acquiring salary. But I don't think that the general managers have an appetite to do it because they're all thinking, well, what if this eventually happens to me? Would I want to take advantage of it? Probably. And I think that they don't have an appetite to change it on the GM level because the salary cap is already so restrictive and tight that any ability to open it up and add another impact player is something that the general managers are probably not going to want to get rid of. So yeah. I doubt we see any change with it at all, unless Gary Bettman and the competition committee go, hey, is this a problem? Yes or no?
Well, I know you guys already talked about that. Thanks for the heads up, Kyle, you asshole. But Ryan, that's an interesting tip to you here. I just think it's funny that, you know, Tampa Bay is the one that raised it at the meeting so long ago, and then they're the benefactor of it first, right? Like, I just think that's awesome. One of those little tidbits in the wild history of hockey. I got to correct myself on one thing before you continue, Dwayne. Edmonton has climbed themselves into third place into that that division. They're at 74. Nashville and Vegas currently hold the two wild card spots, but Dallas is 1 point behind Vegas. Yeah, I mean, Vegas, 4 points. Vancouver, 4 points. Anaheim, 7 points. But, you know, it looks like they're selling off their pieces. So it'll just be interesting finish to see where that, you know, wouldn't it be – what would be the reaction in Vegas if they don't make the playoffs, Dwayne?
Well, I don't want to say to be like a there wouldn't be a coaching change, would there? Especially after they fired Gallant and then brought in DeBoer. That wouldn't make sense. I think with Vegas, you know, I think the biggest mistake they made was probably trading Fleury, right? That's probably been their Achilles heel this season, is just not getting the goaltending. And then obviously the injuries have killed them this season. You've had Mark Stone on LTIR. Pacioretty's been in the lineup. Alec Martinez being out, you know, you acquired Jack Eichel before the season started, but you traded an important piece like Alex Tuch, who, you know, in there, he played in their bottom six, but he's a big, you know, he was a really loved by the fan base there. And he was probably a big part of that locker room. And, you know, you just dealt with injury and then Carlson not performing well this season. That's been a huge disappointment for them. I think last time I checked, he had 7 goals in the season. This guy was a 43 goal scorer. So I think for me, I think I don't know if they make any changes front office wise, but I do think that you're going to see some names, you know, leave the organization. Cause I think, I mean, Robin Leonard is a good goalie, but I just don't know if he's really 1A material.
Well, yeah, but you mentioned that the key thing I think is Fleury. I mean, he's a 40 game winner in every, I mean, good team he's been on. He's a 40 game winner, probably guaranteed throughout the regular season. You know, and that's a big piece. Obviously not having that is a big piece. I mean, the goaltending there has been a little suspect. And Leonard, I mean, again, when the whole thing was going down with Fleury and Leonard, and, you know, obviously saw Alan Walsh's tweet a couple of years ago. I mean, and again, Robin Leonard, great story, all that, but he's never been a one.
He's never been a 1A. He's been a good 1B.
Yeah.
But then again, Fleury was there. I want to go back, Dwayne. You said it all happened when they traded away Fleury. I think it all happened when they signed Leonard to that extension.
Mm-hmm.
The writing was on the wall there that, you know, obviously you're not going to get rid of the guy you just signed to extension. So the writing was on the wall for Fleury. I just think that he was so important to that franchise. It was obvious he still had gas in the tank. Maybe – I don't know. I just think that it's funny you brought that up, Quickie. I love Walsh's new podcast, Agent Provocateur. He does a great job at getting some interesting insight in there. But I don't know. If that's the reason that comes back to bite them, how ironic is that? And now Minnesota, who's in, you know, in their conference, picking him up, you know, that could be a potential. Yeah, no, probably won't be because Minnesota's third. But unless Vegas goes on a tear. But it'd just be interesting to see, you know, if they could find a way to meet in the playoffs, if Fleury could get his redemption there. But he's still got gas in the tank. I think you guys all saw the pictures last night of the him playing without his glove. Like, he's, love yeah. that. Gotta love it.
You got to be crazy to do that.
Yeah, I mean.
He's a goalie. Like
something I would do.
That would chop your hand off first.
I think he's got enough in the tank. And to go back a little bit further, look how much it's affected Pittsburgh, right? Ryan, you mentioned them earlier. But some of these teams in the Eastern Conference, me and Dwayne talked about it with Butcher Gross, like your Washington's, your Pittsburgh's, even your Boston's, their windows are slowly closing, right? Like, I'm not saying they're not going to be out of it in the next year or two, but they're not as good as they once were. Their core is only getting older and not in a good way. So,
yeah.
This just from Kevin Weeks, the guy who's been pretty much breaking trades in a new location pretty much every time he breaks a trade. Lakenen to the Colorado Avalanche for Barron and a second round pick. And then Josh Brown and a seventh round pick to the Bruins for forward Zach Sensenin and a fifth
Tenishin.
Round.
Sensenin. Yeah, sorry about that, guys. And then from Frank Saravelli, bad they're really pick. Starting to pound them in now. Like one after the other. The St. Louis Blues are getting Nick Leddy from the Red Wings. That just from
That deepens their decor. That's what we're talking about.
I was a teammate of Letty's at the Team USA Hlinka tournament, and boy, oh boy, can that guy move. He's got great boots. Me and Kyle played against him most of our life. I know he was out in Minnesota, but he was always with that Blades team that was dominant. He's been a good player. He's been a stalwart. Where was Leddy when he got traded?
Red Wings to St. Louis.
Interesting.
Yeah. Well, again, Letty's been moved around, obviously, since Chicago, but he's always gone to teams and made an impact. Now, we were talking about Cam Jansen being on last time, and again, I think that's a great – that's a great move for St. Louis because he was talking about their D shoring up, and he shores up that D. His cap hit's probably not – I don't know his cap hit, but it's probably not that high. Oh, yeah, and he's going to shore up, and he's going to log a lot of minutes, you know, when it comes time for him to do it. But the Sinishin one is funny. And, again, I just – you know, that draft, this –
the three Bruins back-to-back picks. Well, they hit on one of them with Pasta.
Yeah.
But, like, he was the most – like, I feel like most unknown at the time. He turns out to be the best of –
maybe I think he was draft, in Sioux. Right? He was in the Sioux with Bailey with Justin.
Who?
And Sinishin was in the Sioux with Justin, right? He was in really? The Sioux.
He was the Sioux Greyhound. Yeah.
Yeah. I remember
really good pick, OHL player.
Yeah, but I remember when that pick came through. I remember Bailey because I was with Barnaby at the time, and Bailey was like, "Okay, you know." But first again, Barnaby, that was you know, and nothing against guys, but you know, it's tough. Like you get in that spot and. You know, you've seen the Sabres make these mistakes in the first round. You cannot miss. When you have three in a row, you have to hit two, you know. I mean, hit two, you're in a good spot. But, again, it's hard to miss. I mean, you look at the Zadorov. Who is it? Zadorov, Gergensen? Or was it Gergensen?
Gregorenko.
Gregorenko. Yeah. Yeah, Gergensen's first round. I mean, Gergensen is panned out as a fourth line player, but that's not what they're projecting him as. And in the USHL that year, he was a good player. He wasn't a first round pick. So again, I mean, these picks, you look back and everyone could say, you know, hindsight 2020, but you know, it's interesting to see the picks get moved and then see what's coming back. And you know, that's the cool thing about the deadline day. I've always been a fan of the deadline day just because of that, because it's so interesting to watch and see how these affect teams for the long run versus the short run and all that stuff. So, you know, the Sabres, hopefully they get some moves done here, but I don't know. I think Petey just tweeted out there. Yeah, I think the Peters just tweeted out, it doesn't look like much is going to happen. But at the end of the day, they, you know, I see them, you know, they may not move stuff today, the Sabres, if we're talking about them, but they have draft capital, the first round picks. They have that Florida pick. One of the doctors I work with, his PA is really, he's dialed in when it talks to prospects. And I was talking to him, and again, he's all over this stuff. He's like, you know, move that Florida pick for a player. You know, and again, that, who is the guy that's projected like third overall, the 6'4" forward, he loves him. But you know, again, it'll be interesting to see what they do, because sometimes having these first round picks aren't always great for like where the Sabres are right now, because you need bodies for stability, like for a Darlene, you know, so you have to find contracts that work within that. And I think it'll be interesting to see if the Sabres do stuff today or wait till after the season, when I think they have more leverage at the end of the season with these picks versus rushing stuff today.
Yeah, and you talk about all these teams that are using long-term injured reserve to get through into the playoffs. Well, that's, they're going to have to fix that come September or August, right? So, like you said, or July, right? Mm-hmm. And I think you hit the nail on the head, Quickie, that it gives the Sabres a lot more leverage come that time, pre-draft or at the draft, whatever you want to call it. So, it'll be really interesting to see it shake out.
Here's some news. Vancouver claims off waivers as Arizona claims Sateri.
The goalie?
Yep, I believe so.
they messed with Toronto.
Vancouver claims Richardson. Seattle claims Pouliot. Mrazek clears. And then Riley Nash, Turris, Yaros, and Kyle Clifford all clear too. I'm not going to lie. I like Kyle Clifford. I think he would fit in well on this bottom six of the Sabres.
I do too.
Tough son of a bitch.
Mm-hmm.
Another breaking news tweet from same thing. Laikkanen. You know, Laikkanen to the Avalanche for Justin Barron and a second round pick. That's a huge pickup for the Avalanche, if you ask me. I think those are very reactionary to what's going on, obviously, with the Lightning and the Florida Panthers. Those teams are really starting to, you know, build their roster to get ready for the playoffs. And you don't want when you're Colorado with all the expectations that are kind of just, you know, on them with this team not really, really successful in the playoffs, you know, not being able to even get to the not being able to get to the finals. But you know, it's, you know, there's a ton of pressure on them, so that's a good move for them.
Yeah, it is. And I mean, yeah, he's maybe a guy that flies a little under everybody's radar, particularly because he's playing on an awful team, but Colorado, another team, right? And rightly so, you know, they're going for it, and they should, based on how that team's played. In an 18-game home winning streak this year. Yes, Landeskog is out, and they're hopeful that he can maybe be back in time for middle, maybe end of the first round, certainly probably the second round, which I think most people would project them getting to. They're playing really well. Kemper's come around after a really tough start there. And to add a guy like Lekkonen, who's got, hey, playoff experience, a deep run last year where he scored some big goals. Like, this guy doesn't shy away from the physical stuff either. I think it's actually underrated how gritty he can be. And Colorado, they do not need much more in the way of skill, but you can never have too much of that pushback and snarl in the playoffs. And he brings a little bit of both and a pretty reasonable cap hit. I don't hate the return for Montreal getting a good young D in Barron, who's going to be a bit of a project, probably 3-4 years away from consistent NHL play. But I think that's a bit of a win for both teams, to be honest.
Kyle, before we have to leave, I wanted to get your reaction and I could, you know, Dwayne, you could continue. Maybe you guys touched on it early, but Philip Myers going unclaimed. Kyle, being a defenseman, seeing him What are your thoughts on that happening? Could he have helped Buffalo?
Yeah, I mean, again, I just think it's hard. You know, could he have helped Buffalo? Probably. But, you know, is it a long-term piece for Buffalo?
Yeah.
That's the question. You know what I mean? Like, the Sabres, I mean, and again, like me and Dwayne were talking about it. Sabres right now, I mean, I think their biggest thing is finding D partners for Dahlin and Power long-term, okay? And then up front, some bottom six guys that, you know, can play the bottom six role and be effective, still score goals, be effective, and then a goalie. I mean, that is Buffalo to a T right now, because they're showing right now that they have the ability to win games with, I mean, I would say holes in the roster. 100%. You know, so again, like adding a piece like that, yeah, it could help, but like, is it, and I, again, talking about it, is it worth adding a piece that you don't know is the right piece for what you need to build long-term? And that's the question. I think that's where Adams has been very good, or whoever's calling the shots, Carmanos, Adams. I mean, whoever's doing it is being very calculated lately with what they're doing versus the past regimes of where we are now. They're very calculated. Their pieces, what they're adding, they know their slots. They know what they're doing, and they're doing the right thing by the organization and the city. They're not just adding Ville Leino because it's Ville Leino. I mean, we're not doing that anymore. You know, I mean, so again, I you know, there's been some guys on waivers this year that you're like, you know, like I know Nick Ritchie. I mean, that could be a piece like that, you know, that type of player. Like, I wouldn't mind adding that stuff. But like, if we're talking, you know, defensemen, you know, my biggest thing being a skill guy is I want a guy on my other side of me that, you know, can stick up for me. I don't need, and, you know, if he give me the puck, I'll move the puck up the ice. But if someone puts me into the wall, you're right there grabbing him before he puts me into the wall.
One of the biggest things that you have always, you know, and I've kind of stolen it from you as a coach, is good defensemen always find a way to put their partner in good spots, in better spots, right? And I think you hit the nail on the head there. I know you got dad duty. I don't want to hold you off.
Real quick, the official trade for between the Blues and the Red Wings. Detroit receives Jake Walman, Oscar Sundquist.
I really like him.
And a 2023 second-round draft pick. St. Louis gets Nick Leddy and Luke Witowski.
Witowski, okay. Yeah, old name.
I see these returns. How is Buffalo not making any moves right now? I'm not saying they have a ton to work with, but this trade market is just all over the place. There's got to be some value on a couple of these UFAs.
Yeah.
But to Kyle's point, I mean, like, this has been our mistake in the past. It's been the reactionary. Maybe Carmanos and Adams have everything they feel like they need in place, and they're waiting until they have more leverage, at, you know, not at this deadline, right? Like, you're right, Dwayne. Could something come about? But, like, what pieces do we have to sell that have actual value that you're willing to get rid of?
I think the biggest thing is taking money on. That's the biggest, retaining those salaries. Yeah, that's our biggest piece right now. But at the end of the day, if you're not getting the right piece back for the long-term build, you're not – why do it? Like, you're wasting
Even have the option from the Pegulas to do that, though? Like,
we don't know that. I mean, they said they had that. But, again, I mean, retaining salary, I don't need more draft picks for that either. Like, we're not – we don't need draft – we need legitimate young players.
Bodies on entry level that can contribute. Yeah.
But, you know, the Wallman – get Wallman, I mean, when he was at Providence, guys, like, I remember, you know, watching him play, and it was like, wow.
Really good.
Like, wow.
Good, like, skater, this, good on his edges, hard shot. Mm-hmm. Really, I mean, the best compliment I could give him is he's got such a low panic threshold already.
Yes.
He's really, really intelligent with the puck. You rarely see him, especially in the college playoffs that year.
Yeah.
You rarely ever saw him make a bad outlet pass.
100%.
He can put it on your tape.
Him and
they need that.
The kid, you know, and the one, him and he was with Bryson there. And again, like, you know, I respect very skilled defensemen who can move the puck up the ice and make it look easy. And those guys are guys like that. And Witowski, when he was at Western Michigan, this is a long time ago, I mean, he was the same way. He was a big prospect for Tampa back then. I mean, you know, so Yzerman, he was actually in Tampa, and I'm not surprised he took on Witowski because he was in Tampa when Witowski was a prospect there. So, again, I got to run, but, I like that piece for both sides. So, you know, it's a good pickup. Yeah. So,
per David Pagnotta, too, the Golden Knights are working on a trade involving Evgeny Dadonov.
Yeah,
They got to get rid of him.
Yeah.
Quickie, it was great to see you, bud.
Yeah, nice seeing you guys. I'll see you guys soon. And Colin, I'll see you Tuesday, when I see
brother.
You. Yeah,
I'll,
see you, bud.
I'll see you holiday Tuesday, brother. Be good.
Okay. See you, bud. Bye, guys.
So thanks for Kyle Quick for hopping on with us. Always been fun, you know, since he's been, you know, kind of becoming a normal face on the show. And you, obviously, you too, Ryan. We're 39 minutes away from, I'm sorry, no, 48 minutes away from deadline. Obviously you always see some trades kind of roll in right around maybe a few minutes after. One of the things, what was the trade that really took everyone by surprise? The Mantha trade last year, right? That was the one that really took a lot of people by surprise. I wonder if and that kind of happened right at the deadline. I wonder if we'll get something like that today.
I'm sure we will. And yeah, I mean, and it's funny you bring that up. I can speak well that being a Caps fan. And obviously I was a little sad to, I don't want to say give up on, but, you know, kind of sell. They sold high on Jake Virana, and I hope he has lots of success in Detroit. He certainly started off well with a 4-goal game. Obviously just got back in the lineup. Incredibly quick guy. The thing that he's going to have to work on to become what everybody thinks he can become, which is a consistent 25 goal scorer, is his intelligence out there. He knows he's a guy that's fast and knows it, and maybe knows it a little too well. And so he puts himself out of position a lot because he knows, well, I can keep up and I can skate back and get back in position. But, you know, in the NHL, it doesn't matter how fast you are sometimes. Guys can take advantage of holes that you leave them very quickly. And so I know that was something that the coaching staff in Washington at the time had a bit of a problem with. Hey, he's a Stanley Cup champion. No one can ever take that away from him. He scored a very, very big goal in the cup clinching game. But I was very excited to get Anthony Mantha because he just fits in a little bit more with the group that Washington's kind of put together. Big, nasty, pushy around, and hey, I'll score a goal bar down too. And look what's happened to Washington after having a pretty inconsistent year so far since he's come back. They have been dynamite, and he's been dynamite. He's almost a point per game player coming back from that injury, and Washington's 7-1-2 since he's come back. So yeah, that was a shocker, I think, last year, because I think a lot of people thought Mantha would be a locked-in piece for Detroit, but they wanted to go younger. They got, and the two teams kind of got what they needed in that deal, and I'm sure we're probably going to see something else like that eventually coming down the stretch of the deadline here.
Your thoughts, Cully?
No, I mean, you're always... The way I've always understood it to be, and it's similar at the OHL level, and Ryan can attest to this, is it's just got to clear the league office by, what is it, 3 p.m., 2 p.m.? Is it 3 p.m.?
Yeah, 3 p.m. So
a lot of times, you know, some of these bigger trades that, you know, maybe aren't as obvious or haven't been talked about and are reactionary come in late because pieces are starting to fall off the board. A team's plan A and plan B are gone, and they need to address this. So plan C it is, and we got to throw this together in 30 minutes as long as they can get it in time, and we won't know until maybe, I don't know, I remember a couple years ago we found out a trade about an hour after, right? So, like, it's not unusual to see that.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, the biggest thing, right, is that we see a lot of that flurry of activity in the last hour a lot of the time. And the reason you hear about trades like 20 minutes, half hour, sometimes an hour later is they all come flying into the league office at once. As long as the two teams get their emails in, I know they're not faxing it anymore. As long as it's registered on both sides before 3 p.m., the trade is valid. The league just has to officially stamp it. But as long as the deal is approved by both sides and it's in with approval before 3, the trade is valid. So That's why you'll probably see some late breaking stuff here. I do want to comment too, you know, talking about Buffalo and their inactivity, and you know, Cully made a good point, is that who's the number one guy that they were selling? It was Olofsson.
And Olofsson, or I would say Colin Miller. Yeah.
Yeah. And Miller maybe is more of a surprise to me, because the thing with Olofsson is, I think what Buffalo's doing is they are not going to overreact and try and just move somebody for the sake of moving them, especially given the way the team's playing right now. And you would be selling Olofsson low because of the way he's played lately. I think their hope is, they're probably thinking this, his stock isn't going to get lower because people still know what he's capable of when he's playing really well. And he hasn't played well this year. So if we wait till the draft, people aren't going to think worse of him than they think now. And so maybe it stays here. The price stays here. They're probably thinking, what if we move him here and then he scores, you know, 9 goals down the stretch for somebody. And maybe he could have done that here and we could have got this at the draft. 100%. That's what I think they're thinking is, we're going to sell this guy that we know is talented here, but maybe at the draft we could sell him here or here. I'm sure that that's probably what they're thinking.
If it's in terms of a guy like Cody Eakin. He might not be, you know, a very offensively gifted hockey player, but one thing I will say about Cody Eakin is he's been very good in his own on the penalty kill, and he's been easily been our best faceoff guy throughout the season. And I feel like there is some value for that for teams. Like, I'm kind of surprised that you can't even, with some of these returns you're seeing, that you can't even squeeze like a 4th-round pick out of Cody Eakin, a guy that's obviously not part of the future plans of this team.
It's just got to be a right fit, right situation, right, Dwayne? Like, a lot of teams really already have that guy that is a face-off, like, you know, call him lacrosse, the Fogos, the face-off get-offs.
Yeah.
That's a bottom six guy. Hate to say this, but Ryan, you can attest to this a little bit. Most of the forwards I play with in the OHL were all centers and the best players on their minor hockey teams growing up that transitioned to wing. Right. And, and throughout, you know, the OHL to the AHL to, or the East Coast to the AHL to the NHL, guys that, you know, might've been goal scorers their whole life realize that, hey, I need to craft out, you know, a niche position for me to be able to make it in this league. And like, I don't want to say guys like Cody Eakin are a dime a dozen, but I want to say, I'm not undervaluing them, but I just don't think you would get a great return on him. And to go back to Ryan's point, if the return isn't great, why mess with what's happening right now?
I guess. Yeah. I'm just being your typical Sabres fan.
In a big way.
I'm just being your typical Sabres fan at the deadline.
Well, it's the deadline, right? Like, everybody wants to see their team do something. Because it's exciting, and especially for a rebuilding team, everybody wants something to happen because they want to look forward to that next puzzle piece. Well, we got this for this guy. We could take these picks, turn them into a better pick. Everybody wants to see their team do something. I'm happy the Caps did something. I mean, bring Marcus Johansson back. Like
Johan Larsson was just shipped to the Capitals too.
There you go. And I like that pickup as well. It's a good depth move for them. And I mean, you know, Daniel Sprong, unfortunately, just didn't really work out. And he might be running out of time in the NHL. It's his fourth franchise with Seattle. He didn't work out. And the Caps bring back a guy that's very familiar to them. Just missed out on that cup party, unfortunately. And maybe bringing an old pal back into the locker room that fit in well will do quite a bit for the Caps room, which is already really tight knit. But at the end of the day, like, I would have said, you know, if we didn't have the bottom six that we have in Washington, I say we, you know, I don't work for the team. The bottom six already said, because Eakin used to be a Washington Capital. And if there was room on the roster, he would be a guy that I would want Washington to go out and get. But unfortunately, in that situation, we've already got Eller and we've already got Nick Dowd, who's having a career year. I love Nick Dowd, and I want him to be a Capital for a very long time. So teams like that, in Washington's case, already have that sorted out. Pittsburgh's already got that sorted out. There aren't a lot of contenders right now that are looking for something like that. They're out there, but do they want to give up a pick when they're a mid-tier contender and thinking, I don't know if necessarily we can go deep in the playoffs, we'll make it. Like, is Nashville going to do a deal like that, right? Is Vegas going to do a deal like that? I don't know. It's that's when it becomes hard, when you've got those bit players. And like, it's no disrespect, like what Cully said. Like, I agree. Cody Eakin, guys like that are a dime a dozen. You can find tons of guys like that. There are guys playing in the AHL right now that can fill that role. They're just not getting an opportunity. So how valuable is that to some of the high-end teams that have already got that sorted out? I don't know. It's really hard to say.
Yeah. Cully, your feelings? Actually, before that, Andrew Cogliano dealt to the Colorado Avalanche per Bob McKenzie.
Wow. I mean, Colorado, again, just adding every little piece they can. They're looking forward, you know, in terms of potential injuries. Gabe Landeskog obviously already out. They are building themselves a buffer. And, Cogliano is an elite penalty killer, an extremely good skater, and he's a guy that can bring a little bit of jump on their third and fourth line. Good veteran guy, been on long playoff runs before. He'll help them out.
Yep. Cully, your thoughts?
I like the depth piece. I've always been a fan of Cogliano's. It's a shame what the NHL did with his Iron Man streak.
Yeah.
Years ago, that one kicked me in the nuts. Because he's just so well liked and really well talked about. But you talk about a group in Colorado, and you remember, Ryan, were you in the league when Landeskog was in the league?
I wasn't covering the league, but I went to a lot of those Rangers games.
So me and Dwayne talked about it last episode when we were talking to Ryan Michaels. Was it Dwayne?
Yep.
And just speaking.
No, Jack Michaels.
Jack Michaels. I called him Jack Edwards, and I had to pay for my job. So I like you look at what anytime a guy like Landeskog, I remember him just being such a culture guy. You knew he was a great leader and the way he played. I think that they've created, a destination where obviously, you know, process over results, but the results speak for themselves because they've taken care of that process and put together such a great product, right? Like 44, 13 and 5, right? Like their winning percentage is 750. How often do we see that? So for them to pick up complementary pieces without disrupting the core, the culture that's within that building, I think is extremely important. And to have, you know, a GM that understands that, I think, is extremely important. So what did they end up giving up for him, Dwayne?
A fifth round pick, it looks like.
Like, to me, that's 100%. Like, if he can help you, even if he doesn't contribute a ton on the ice, he's a guy that's been there before that can help some of these young guys. We've talked a lot about the Leafs and not being getting over that first hurdle. But, you know, you hear it on the network all day and all last night. Like, you know, Colorado's a team that really hasn't been able to get to the conference finals. And with all their talent, like, you wonder why. And you can go back to a lot of reasons, but, you know, this has got to be the year that they think that it's got to happen, right? You got McKinnon on still what I consider a very team-friendly deal. And that's coming up too, right? Like, and he's gone on the record saying he'll do whatever it takes to win, but at some point, you know, you got to take care of yourself. And I don't know. I like the trade. To answer your question in short, Dwayne, I think anytime you can add a guy like Cogliano with experience and veteran leadership that can still play the game at a high enough level at a depth role for a fifth rounder, is that fifth rounder going to come back to bite Colorado? No. Could Cogliano be the voice of reason in a game seven? Or could he be the guy that, you know, chips in on the penalty kill that blocks a shot to get them over that hump? I think it's 100% worth it.
Yeah. And Zach Sanford just dealt. I'm sorry, I just lost the tweet. Zach Sanford has just been dealt though too as well. Sanford traded from Ottawa to Winnipeg. So there's Winnipeg adding another piece to the puzzle. And these deals just keep rolling in as we get closer and closer to 3 o'clock. And just a thought, if Buffalo's only deal at the deadline is in fact Robert Hag, which happened yesterday for a 6th round pick, you know, where do we go from there? You know, is this, you know, come the draft, are we a team that's looking to even like use all three of those 1st round draft picks that we've accumulated? Because I honestly fully expected, I know we mentioned this before, but I fully expected Kevin Adams to be active today and making deals, increasing some draft stock, and maybe you know turning those picks into actual players, you know, not via the draft, but you know, maybe a deadline, maybe a draft day deal. Like where does Buffalo go from here? Like I said, I just tweeted it out, you know, less than 40 minutes for Kevin Adams to decide if Robert Hag is the only deadline deal here for the Sabres. And we have a lot of people watching and wondering, so where does Buffalo go from here? If in fact, Robert Hag is the only deadline deal that he makes, and what's the reaction? What will the reaction be from Sabres fans?
I'll go first, Ryan, then I'll kick it over to you. I've kind of hinted at it before. I think Carmanos coming in was a big piece to help Kevin. I would like to believe that learning from our past mistakes of dealing at a time of weakness, like Ryan talked about with Olofsson, right? It makes perfect sense to me to stand pat and be okay with that. Now, I can understand the fan base wanting to see something done after what we collectively have been through. But how do I say this the right way? I think that the smart GM in the room is one that's going to, you know, buy low, sell high, and not rush things into a window just to get fan, you know, support. Wouldn't the fans rather have a team that's better off next year to actually make a run into the playoffs than trying to make a deal this deadline that doesn't make sense for our future? And I hate to keep saying that. And you want to be one of these teams that's adding and going for it sooner than later, but to give up a piece where you can potentially get more or have that piece be a part of your team going forward just to rush it, I'm okay with standing pat. If that's the only move is Robert Hag, then so be it. I am not privy to everything that goes across Adam's desk. If something blows their socks off, I'm sure they'll consider it, and I'm sure they'll probably pull the trigger if it makes sense with their timeline. I don't have that. I think their timeline is you know, get playoff experience next year, the year after that, see where our you know, our Owen Powers are, our Tage Thompsons are, our younger guys are, our Alex Tucks are, and then maybe we can be adders. That's just my thought. I've been on enough teams and have seen the business part of it to know that teams that kind of rush their way through this and make rash decisions sometimes ends up biting them in the ass. Ryan, your thoughts?
Yeah, I completely agree. You know, I'll go back to a quote that Brian Burke said, and he referenced it in his book. You know, as a general manager, you're oftentimes judged in the public eye by the trades you do make, but within the hockey world, you're kind of almost more judged on the deals you don't make. And there's something to that, right? Like, I think that Buffalo is in such a spot where they've got seemingly a good collection of young guys that they can really build around, that like each other, want to be Sabres, and want things to improve there. So that's a good start. What they have to do now is be patient enough to recognize when is the right time to start adding the veteran guys on longer term deals, potentially, that supplement this roster and help take those young guys from here to here in terms of competitiveness and success, right? We already saw this in Buffalo. They tried to ram their way through a rebuild with Eichel. They signed Okposo. They signed a bunch of guys right away, splashing money because the Pegulas wanted to throw cash around. And in hockey and really in sports in general, having money is great, but throwing your money at roster problems when it's too early to do that can really set you back a few years. And it did with the Sabres, and they're not the only team that have had that problem. Right. So look at Vancouver, look at Winnipeg right now. So I think that they're taking the right approach here because they've got a lot of draft capital for an upcoming draft that has a ton of uncertainty around it because we've seen so many of these guys not be able to play in this draft class leading in. So there's a lot of uncertainty there, right? I think that it's probably a good idea for them to hold on to some of these assets for the draft and potentially move them for pieces in next year's draft and start compiling more young talent that you can eventually use because draft picks are great. But when you can compile some more good young talent that another team may want, and you go, okay, we've got Cousins, we've got Tuck, we've got Mittelstadt, Dahlin. We don't have room for all of these great young players that we've drafted. You do, and you've got a guy that we would really love to pair with Rasmus Dahlin. That's when you start to package your extra assets up. Look what Tampa's done. Look what Washington did for years. Pittsburgh. We've drafted well, and we can take some of these extra assets we have and move them to supplement this roster and start being competitive. You have to have the patience to see that stuff through. And I think so far, Kevin Adams is showing that that's his approach.
Well said, Ryan. I couldn't agree more.
I definitely agree with you too. One of the names that was been throwing around a lot in the last 2 weeks since he got back from injury was Vinny Hinostroza. There's been rumors that maybe Kevin Adams be interested in bringing him back because he's liked what he's done. A guy who cost you league minimum, wasn't really expected to be a piece going forward, but maybe he will be, maybe he won't be. But that's another guy too. I just coming to mind, I thought might have had some value with how well he's played in their bottom six on a team that wasn't expected to do much at all, win much at all this year. And I think he might have like 10 goals or something like that, which I mean is nothing to sneeze at. But for a guy like him, that's a great year. And do you see a guy like Vinny Hinostroza being part of this team in the future? Or should we expect him to at least maybe him be a guy dealt at 3 p.m.?
I don't think there's a ton of value there. And I think that other teams too, going back to that Burke quote, Ryan, it was awesome that you brought that up. Dwayne, I think part of the reason that he's finding success is that he's been put into roles. And you say bottom six. I'm going to say middle six. Because when you look at the roster last night, who was he playing with?
I'm not
on the second line. Sorry, I wasn't trying to set you up there, but I'm just saying, like, he's a guy that, yeah, I know he's making league minimum, but I think he's a product of, you know, on all these teams that are adding, he would be, you know, in and out of the lineup versus here where he's producing those numbers because he's been given the chance to. Now, I think he's a guy that, you know, if somebody comes along with the right offer, you take it, right? But where do you value him? I think that he's shown that he can slot in at every, you know, at every in any position in your lineup and any line, and can be a good penalty killer. And is well liked by his teammates. Is excited to come to work here in Buffalo every day. And is chipped in with some decent numbers. That he hasn't maybe in the past. But I think that he's a guy that, you know, if traded, would he put up the same numbers? Probably not, because he wouldn't be given the same ice time. I think that a lot can be said to Don Granato and his coaching staff's use of him and how their trust is built. I love listening to Vinny talk to the media because he's like a Tuck in the sense that he exemplifies what it means to be a Buffalo Sabre, and he's proud to be here. So I think that he's a guy that probably will get, you know, maybe a little bit of a raise. Not, you know, it's obviously not going to be huge, but, you know, if you're behind the scenes and you like what you see from him, could he be a, you know, a bridge guy till some of our prospects get here on an affordable deal? Why not? I just don't think there's much of a market for a guy like that.
Maybe not. Maybe not.
Yeah, it's tough to say, right? Because a lot of the contenders have kind of already done a lot of their heavy lifting previous to today and now today, right? So teams are kind of running out of room for guys. I mean, you can only have so many guys on NHL contracts, right? So, yeah, it. And again, he might be a guy that Buffalo could retain And then flip next year if he continues to play as well as he's played in a short period of time with the Sabres, right? I mean, that would be good asset management. You know, you any trade you make, you generally want to sell high as possible, right? So maybe they think that they're going to be able to turn him into an asset, and maybe they don't think that right now moving somebody like that that's fit in pretty well is worth their time for what? A sixth round pick, a fifth round pick. They've got tons of those. So maybe they think, hey, we could hold on to him and maybe he becomes a consistent asset, or maybe he continues to play well and next year we turn him into a fourth round pick. Who knows?
Yeah, you're right. I've personally liked Vinny's game. Obviously, he kind of stood out there in that Heritage Classic. He's not a finesse guy. He's a decent skater, but, you know, he's a guy willing to put the puck on net and really, you know, bury his head and dig for rebounds. And that's what I've kind of always liked about his game. I remember when we first signed him, friend of the program, Greg Day there, Cully, and Anthony.
Hey, sir.
You know, the good friend of Anthony Day back in, you know, the Yale days playing college and whatnot. And I know Mama Day was really, really excited when they signed Vinny to that contract, even for it was a 1 year league minimum. So I haven't minded his game. Again, you know, if they were to bring him back on like another 1 year deal for like for one schmil, I don't mind it. Again, just the fan in me just really wants to see their team kind of more, a little bit more active on deadline day. Again, if they don't do any, make any moves, I'm not going to be overly, it's not going to be like when the only move the Sabres made on deadline day, like 15 years ago was Bob Corkum.
You don't blasphemize Bob Corkum. I was
the big deadline deal. And I was like, you know, even back then, as young as I was, like Bob Corkum. That's what we did. Bob Corkum. I don't know if you ever played a game in a Sabres sweater, but that was the deal they made. And but obviously, these circumstances are a little different. Kevin Adams is really adamant and wanting players that want to be here. Maybe Vinny is one of those guys. But again, I, of course, with 33 minutes leading into the deadline here, the Sabres actually haven't announced that they're done. Normally, that leads me to believe that maybe the phones are still active. If Kevin Adams wasn't planning on doing anything, you know, they normally would tweet something like that out. Yeah, we're done. We don't plan on making any moves.
That has not been tweeted out yet. Why would you do that? I think that
teams do that. Teams do that.
Maybe it's a mirage. Maybe it's not. But I think that, you know, I think that you listen to everything that comes in if you're Kevin Adams. I think that's the way I've approached it. And I've said it before. I can understand why fans want there to be a splash. But it's got to be the right splash at the right price and for the right player, like Ryan touched on. And I think that the way this team is trending, you know, we still have guys like J.J. Paterka and Jack Quinn and Owen Power that have yet to arrive, Derek Portillo and Devon Levi that are still in the pipeline. We have 10 picks, if I'm not mistaken, in the draft, right? Mm-hmm. Do you need 11 to make no? Like, I think that we have enough capital, like you and Ryan have alluded to, where if we do want to go out and use some of those picks to acquire a live body that can help us now, I think we have enough. Mm-hmm. Do you want to fuck with the culture and the roster and remove a piece for a fifth or a sixth round pick that does, like, for a guy that's really well liked and that is a glue guy in that locker room? Those are things that we aren't privy to. I that's the way I look at it. Now, I you know, if you're Kevin and Jason, you obviously are going to hear everybody out because you might find somebody desperate that's willing to overpay for an Olofsson or a guy like that. Mm-hmm. I just think that logic, you know, and recency tends to say that the teams that have done that have really already gone out and addressed those needs. And it would take a panic team on plan C or D to really blow our socks off with a deal that would make sense for us now and in the future.
So what names are left available still that haven't been dealt yet? The bigger names, you know, we've obviously with some Ben Chariot dealt. We've seen Claude Giroux, the biggest name on the list, dealt, you know, your, Hampus Lindholm has been dealt. But what other names are still out there? I'm searching right here online. what is left available. While I do that, does anyone have any names on, you know, on their own list that haven't been that have been traded yet here? You know, again, 20 minutes before the deadline.
Obviously, you know, Jacob Chychrun would be probably the biggest guy that has been rumored to get moved. Now, you know, we're hearing that maybe Arizona doesn't want to move him just yet, and they wait until the draft. And, you know, all this talk about what the Sabres are going to do, I bet you they're pretty noisy at the draft this year. I would be very surprised if, and hey, if they keep all three, good, but I'd be very surprised if one of those, probably, you know, the lowest first round pick that the Sabres own, is not in play for somebody to improve their top four D. And Arizona's probably thinking the same thing. Hey, we've got this guy who scored 20 goals last year and is a really good player. We've got this guy in a very nice looking deal with some term on it. At the draft, is he maybe worth more when he's completely healthy to a team heading into next year that thinks, hey, we're that Jacob Chychrun away from being really, really good? I bet you that's what they're thinking. There's other names out there, though. Like, the day is not over. Rickard Rakell, Max Domi. I mean, there's been a lot of rumors about teams sniffing around him. My Capitals apparently were sniffing around. I think that that's definitely out the window for them after acquiring Marcus Johansson and Jacob Larsson. I don't know where Max Domi fits now, barring something huge. I just don't see that happening. But Domi is an interesting piece out there. Tyler Motte has been talked about a lot out of Vancouver. Jake DeBrusk, he just signed that 2-year extension at $4 million with Boston, asked for a trade earlier this year. Do they keep him around or wait to move him at the draft? Because, of course, the thing with DeBrusk was everybody was kind of afraid of acquiring him at the time because his qualifying offer was going to be 4.4. Now he's locked in for 2 years with cost certainty at 4. Do they hold on to him until the draft, when he could be potentially more of an intriguing piece for somebody? And then you look down the line, Carson Soucy, obviously still in the mix. Colin Miller for Buffalo. He would be maybe the one guy I'd be surprised if they didn't move him, as he's still got some contract certainty. John Klingberg as well. Dallas might be inclined to just hold on to him because they're not that far out of a playoff spot. He's a guy that, you know, brings an awful lot to their lineup, and the guys like him down there. I know he asked for a trade as well. Do they hold on to him? There are still names out there that I'm sure are going to be at play. But, you know, a lot of those guys I mentioned have some cap hits that are going to be tough for some of these upper teams to absorb. Colorado can't absorb much more. Washington can't absorb much more. Minnesota can't absorb much more. So who are you left with? Like, is Carolina sniffing around and going, boy, look at all the improvements. Florida got Giroux. Is that going to be a problem for us? Do we need to do something and add to Aho and Svechnikov? Mm-hmm. Is Toronto? Toronto can't be done. They've got to improve that roster there. I don't like the look of that decor right now with question marks around Jake Muzzin. Are they going to be involved for a Soucy? Are they trying to get involved with Klingberg in a three-way deal where they can get two teams to retain salary? It's going to be hard for some of these teams that are challenging to absorb some of these contracts. That, I'm sure, is part of the stickler of conversations that they're having with teams that own these guys still.
100%. As we're right now leading off the trade bait board, from according to TSN, is Rickard Rakell out of Anaheim, Max Domi second with Columbus. Justin Braun, I thought he was already dealt. He's been dealt. Andrew Kopp, Winnipeg. Tyler Motte, Jacob Chychrun, Jake DeBrusk. I have always liked Jake DeBrusk. He's only 25 years old.
I like him too.
He's a guy I'd love it. I would love with Buffalo. You said Carson Soucy, Arturi Lehkonen already dealt. Jacob Middleton already dealt. But, you know, that as this list stands, Colin Miller was sitting at 11. I'd imagine with a few names in there already dealt, he'd move into the top 10. And then John Klingberg, as you said, with Dallas. Nick Letty's already gone. Calvin DeHaan's name was mentioned yesterday out of Chicago as a guy that could be moved. Nothing happening yet there. And then again, their name, Johan Larsson and Coghlan already dealt. Connor Garland, a name that was thrown around too, that I maybe thought would have been moved and hasn't been yet.
Yeah. And, you know, to go back to the Chychrun point, Ryan, when I don't know if Dwayne mentioned, but when we had Buchogross on last week, it was a great interview. And his biggest, like my biggest takeaway from that interview was, you know, if he were in sitting in Kevin Adams' chair, was that would be the move that he would go after, so that Owen Power would have a guy like him. So, like, hypothetically, like, what would it take to get a guy like Chychrun, in your opinion, Ryan?
Well, I know that Arizona was asking for the world and more. Yeah. I mean, the like, I saw on TSN this morning that the original ask was 2 first-rounders, a second, and a prospect. Then it turned into 3 first-rounders. I don't know if that's necessarily something I'd do, as good as a player as I believe he is. For Buffalo right now, you know, to acquire a guy like Chychrun, you would probably have to put at least, if not 2 of the 3 first-rounders that you own this year, probably a 2nd or 3rd-rounder, and a really good prospect. I don't know how much of an appetite Kevin Adams might have for something like that. However, you know, on the other side of the coin, would you say that maybe it's worth that because of how great his contract is? Like, we're talking about a very impactful left shooting defenseman who hits hard, plays very solid defensively. I know it's hard to track that because he plays for the Coyotes, but he's a really versatile two-way modern day defenseman on just north of a $4 million cap hit. Like, there's a lot of value in that. And I don't blame Arizona for asking for the world, but he is a guy that I think would definitely fit in with what Buffalo is trying to do, and has already gone through a lot of the bumps and bruises along the way to becoming a pro defender. And that might be an interesting conversation that they could have at the draft if Chychrun isn't moved today.
Here's from Amanda Kessel. Greg Wyshynski just from Darren Drager. All indications are Andrew Kopp is heading to the Rangers. Rangers also may be working on Tyler Mott. Those are two huge deals for for the Rangers, a team that's really looking to really make a push this year, especially with the way with Shesterkin has played to an MVP, having an MVP level season in a tough division there. Like, I would expect that's big.
Yeah. And to go back to Ryan's point, does that, you know, if that happens, or if Carolina gets wind of that happening, are they confident with their group? Now, they're obviously sitting 3 points ahead of both the Rangers and Pittsburgh, but, you know, you see teams adding, you know, that are right below you. You know, it comes down to is Brendan Moore and the GM there, are they comfortable with what they have? It's tough, man. Like, this, these last few, like, the last 12 minutes, I guess, are going to be entertaining. I mean, or at least to be a fly on the wall in those GM rooms. It'd be fun to be able to sit in one of these, have access to every single GM call that happens in these last 20 minutes. I think you'd be able to write a best-selling book, or release a most viewed podcast to give up some of the information on just how these deals come about, and what these last, you know, this last half an hour is really all about. I think it's interesting. So you mentioned Mott and Cobb.
Yeah, looking like they, per Darren Drager, could be on their way to the New York Rangers. I would have to imagine it's a good return for both teams.
Yeah, you would think so. You're probably talking at least 2nd and 3rd-round picks, probably not firsts, but and maybe prospects as well, which the Rangers have a plenty of. And I mean, you know, that those are two significant adds for them in terms of depth pieces, right? Because the Rangers are probably thinking, look, we've got the best goalie in the league this year. I mean, obviously, I still think Vasilevsky's the best goalie in the world. If you're telling me I have to win Game 7 today, Vasilevsky's going in net. But Shesterkin is going to run away with the Vezina, and they're thinking, hey, we're a young team. We're still coming out of the final stages of our rebuild. We've got good young pieces here for the future, but why couldn't we do damage? Like, would anybody be terribly shocked if the Rangers ended up in the Eastern Conference final? I wouldn't. You get a goalie that hot and guys up front like Panarin leading the charge, like, and Zibanejad, I wouldn't be super shocked if they were able to grind out a couple 6 and 7 game series against the likes of Carolina, maybe Washington, maybe Boston, those type of teams. They can go head to head with those guys when you've got a goaltender like that. We've seen worse teams than the Rangers ride a goalie to conference finals before. Let's be honest here. Minnesota's done it in the past. So that's probably what they're thinking. Hey, we're still going to retain a lot of our good young prospects, depending on what the returns are. We've still got a good amount of draft capital as well. These are probably two not very damaging ads in terms of giving stuff up for the Rangers that are going to help a young team maybe go to that extra gear. Who knows? I did just notice, too, that Montreal turned Andrew Hammond into Nate Schnarr. A guy I'm very familiar with. I covered him in the GOJHL when he was playing Junior B. And of course, he's a Guelph Storm alum. I think that's really smart asset management by Montreal to take a guy that had basically played himself out of the NHL and then take him and turn him into a goalie depth piece for the Devils and get Nate Schnarr, who's probably still a little rough around the edges in terms of an NHLer, but a big, tall, lanky centerman that can potentially develop into a really solid piece for you. For a guy that was struggling to get back into the NHL, I think that's a really nice trade for Montreal.
I agree.
Maybe I'm a little biased because I like Nate a lot and he's a really good kid, but I mean, you turned nothing into a potential something. I think that's a win every day of the week for Montreal.
And just coming in, the Rangers perhaps clearing cap space. They're sending Anthony Boteto to San Jose. Yep. To be determined is what it says on the return. Maybe it's nothing. Maybe it's just a cap clearing move. Maybe it's a future considerations kind of thing. Maybe that's a precursor to what Dreger was talking about. You know, like we said, coming down the home stretch here is always an interesting time. It's
8 minutes.
You know, for me, you go back to that division, you're going to have to get through. For me, it's Tampa Bay and Florida, right? Like, I've really loved watching Florida and the way they play. I think that they've done a good job addressing their needs early, and not that they even needed to, really. I think that they are, you know, they have two good options in net. Ekblad, thankfully, his injury isn't season-ending, you know, which really hurt them last year. And now, you know, that allows them to help go out and make that trade for Drew a lot easier with him being on LTIR. But, you know, Tampa Bay is still the reigning cup champions. I think it's seeding wise, it's going to be so important for a team like the Rangers to get that good first round matchup, right? To try to surpass Carolina so you don't run into a Tampa Bay or, you know, I don't know, though. It's going to be so interesting because then you look at the wild card right now where it sits with Boston and Washington. I wouldn't want to play either of them in the first round either if I'm any of these teams. But, hey, that's why I'm not in these chairs. And I hope it's true. I hope Dregs is right on this one because that would surely spice up the Metropolitan Division there in that race to the top. Like I said, both Pittsburgh and New York, only 3 point backs of Carolina right now. Carolina has a game in hand. So is Carolina going to react and make a reactionary trade from there? Is there anybody left for them to go out and get that makes sense? Is the big question, right?
Mm-hmm.
TikTok.
It's certainly valid, right? And I mean, for Washington and Boston sitting 1-2 in the wild card spots right now, like Boston, they're only 2 points back of Toronto, and they've played the same amount of games. The Leafs have 2 games in hand on Washington, who are 3 points back of them. Divisionally, they're 5 points back of the Rangers at 2, Pittsburgh at 3, who both have 85. Carolina, obviously, with a little bit of draw distance at 88. But those two teams, especially with the way that Washington and Boston have been playing lately, Washington 7-1-2 on a pretty good run that was ended by Dallas yesterday in regulation, earning points in 9 straight prior to that. Like, they could absolutely go on a run. Ovechkin's doing that thing again where he heats up at the end of the year and starts pumping goals. He hit 40. You know, it's tied Wayne Gretzky, by the way. I just got to plug that. It's you just never know. The seeding is not finished. The seeding is not finished here. So that's probably on some team's mind too. Boy, is there somebody out there that we can add that's going to help us really clinch a potential home ice advantage, right? Because there's a big bunch up there. Like, none of these teams are locked into where they're going to finish outside of the Floridas and Tampas that are putting some space between them. But even Carolina right there with the one seed, Pittsburgh and the Rangers are right behind them. They're right there. So nothing is solved yet in terms of potential seeding. And there are probably, like you mentioned, Cully, teams out there that are saying, I don't necessarily know if I want to play a Boston or a Washington in the first round, because even if we win, those teams will put you through a war. They are not the, my God. I mean, I'm a Caps fan through and through. And I mean, even though the team's had a pretty up and down year, like they've made some noise at the deadline here in smaller moves, of course, but they're approaching it and not doing huge stuff because they're looking at it like they've already got almost as good of a trade addition in getting Anthony Mantha back from injury and Oshie back from injury and guys like Nick Jensen back from injury. So they're looking at it going, well, we just got three really good players, two of which have basically not been in our lineup at all year in Oshie and Mantha. What the hell do we need to go out and get a top six forward for? We just added two for free. And they are going to lean on somebody. I don't necessarily, simply because of the goaltending, I don't necessarily think Washington is, if they won a round, I would be pretty happy with that based on what I've seen out of them this year. But a team having to play them in the first round is going to get punch you in the face, aggressive, no back down hockey for five or six, maybe seven games. And they can take a piece out of you, and Boston can take a piece out of you. So they are not very attractive first round matchups for anybody.
All we have to do is go back to Friday, this past Friday, the 18th, Washington able to play a really tough Carolina team and beat them in a shootout. Right. And that was, from what I remember watching the condensed highlights, it was a heavy game both ways. And like you mentioned, like these seven game series, they don't bode well for, you know, if you have to play a team like that, that A, has experience, and B, might know that they might be outskilled a little bit, but they're going to make you earn every inch of that ice, make you earn every single second of each win. And you're going to have to, you know, for better or for worse, try to come out of that healthy enough to get into that second round, even if you do win, right? Mm-hmm. And then you still got two more. Always loved that 16-win analogy Scotty Bowman used to talk about. Like, hey, every one of the 16 is important. They don't ask how. They ask how many, and it's the first to 16. So it's going to be, you know, an interesting last couple minutes here as news starts to filter in. You know, you wonder what that potato trade is leading to. And obviously I lean on Dwayne here, our guru to let us know, as his news starts to filter in.
Tyler Mott dealt to the Rangers for a fourth round pick. That is surprising. I thought Mott would get a little bit more on that, but that is, those are two huge moves, you know, 10 minutes leading to the deadline, adding, Kopp and Tyler Mott. That, I mean, the Rangers just became a much better hockey team.
Wait, so did Cobb get traded?
Looks like it, yeah.
Kaplan just confirmed he's gone to the Rangers. They're working on the details.
Yep, and Tyler Mott. So
I'd imagine Cobb's return is going to be more than Mott, no?
You'd have to imagine, right?
I certainly think so.
Yeah.
And then,
I would definitely imagine
we're still waiting. Again, the Sabres, I haven't heard anything in terms of them announcing that they're done or, you know, nothing that I've seen yet. But I do know that, again, I am not, as a Sabres fan, I would love to see them at least make something, at least maybe relieve themselves of Colin Miller's services, the guy who really hasn't been in the lineup a lot this year in terms of team chemistry and team culture. I don't know where he fits in, but I mean, if he is still with the team and they couldn't find a trade partner for him, I guess, you know, I'm fine with the team as it sits right now, because they are heading in a positive direction.
And they've been fun to watch. I think that that's something that, you know, even just talking to, you know, my old man about it, it's just, you know, what does it take to stay up to watch a 10 o'clock start Eastern time for a Sabres fan, right? And, you know, to see them eke out these overtime, these exciting wins and have your centerpieces of the team score goals, even if it is a Tage Thompson, you know, capitalizing on a Markstrom, you know, misplay of the puck. But the Dahlin goal yesterday and the fact that we never let – Dwayne, for how long did we see the Sabres lose overtime games because we never even touched the puck? And so to see us, you know, win last night and in a similar fashion to how we lost all those times, and nothing against Eichel, but to see him lose so many opening draws killed me. And then they would throw Sam up front. And I'm a big Sam Reinhart fan. So for the playoffs, I'll be rooting for the Panthers. I wish him nothing but the best. And, you know, I think he's missed more and more every day when we look back at what he contributed. So all the best to Sammy Reinhart going forward. But even a team like Florida, you know, they added their pieces, but it's going to be an interesting, you know, for the talk for so long, it was how close all those teams were in the West for those final spots. But now I think, you know, as we've alluded to, the seeding going into the final stretch here in the East is going to be so important, as you alluded to, Nate. Or Ryan, sorry, I called you Nate. I'm so sorry. That's not a fine for me. Dwayne, that's three fines and two episodes for the kid.
Yeah, buddy. I don't know what's going on with you lately.
Well, let's get lighter every episode, pal.
He's got a lot on his mind, all right? He's breaking everything down. Give him a break here. All right. No, it's valid, right? It's one of those things where, you know, a lot of mistakes are made on this day. And I mean, to bring it back into, you know, the sphere of Buffalo and their fan base, I don't think one thing you can certainly say, yeah, they haven't been very active, but they haven't gone out and made any big mistakes. And they can really sit back and kind of address whatever assets they kept here and turn them into something potentially at the draft. And they're well set up too, right? Maybe they flip two of those first round picks that they have because of how uncertain the draft is this year, right? Like there's a lot. I don't know if there's ever been as much uncertainty around a draft class outside of, you know, the big names like Shane Wright as there is this year. Because so many of these guys, we haven't got to see them play, you know? And I mean, I've seen the OHL guys, you know, so I think I have a pretty good read on who could be a good NHL player. I don't really know though. And I certainly don't think the scouting departments know. They've had to cram an awful lot of work into 5 or 6 months here. Yeah. So, you know, I think the draft is where you're going to see the Sabres be pretty noisy. They have an opportunity to be noisy.
Agreed. PK Subban per Pierre LeBrun staying put. Eric, a staff writer for the Vegas Golden Knights, just tweeted out that it is expected that Ricard Raquel will be announced, that he's being moved after the deadline. So hopefully here shortly we'll get some more news on that. And, of course, Jacob Chychrun staying put in Arizona. They will revisit in the summer. So there's that, more news there. And it looks like, I guess, unless some news squeaks in here again, you know, teams normally announce that they're done. We haven't gotten that, but, looks like
Colorado says they're done.
Colorado says they're done. Yeah. Is that coming from their team account?
Not from their team account, but Peter Baugh, who covers the team down there, just got confirmation from Joe Sakic. They're done. There's no more moves coming from them.
Okay, so I'd assume a guy like John Vogel would probably be all over that for Buffalo. So checking that right here. from John Vogel. Nothing yet. So me, I don't know. Like, here's me holding out hope, but doesn't look like anything coming from the Sabres outside of the Robert Hag deal yesterday. So again, we're going to go live at 5 o'clock. I don't know if you guys will be down for that. Oh, Philadelphia is trading.
I'm around.
Philadelphia is trading Derek Brassard to, hold on, it just disappeared on my face. Phil Kessel will not be traded.
Yeah, I Brassard saw that.
Traded to Edmonton.
Interesting.
Derek Brassard to Edmonton, another probably depth bottom six piece for them. A team that's really kind of, you know, under a lot of pressure to succeed and to have success in the playoffs, much like the Toronto Maple Leafs. Heads might roll in Edmonton if they don't win a playoff round here. And just from Emily, hold on, Ricard to the Pittsburgh Penguins.
Wow, there it is.
That's a big, that's a big addition for the Penguins. Yep. That's they're going for it one more time.
You got to, man. You think about it. You think
they
about
do.
You got an aging core. You still got some concerns in net. Hopefully Drury can bounce back and you know, Santa brought him a glove hand for Christmas this year. So it'll be interesting, but, you know, fan favorite, my favorite, Paul Bissonnette, you know, his tweet 12 minutes ago, everybody, and you won't like this, Ryan, but he pretty much said everybody is a contender in the playoffs in the East, except Washington. I disagree with him. Listen, you got a guy with Ovechkin, you got Backstrom, and you know, if their goaltending can sort itself out, because we've seen, you know, seen them at their best and at their worst. You got John Carlson on the point. You got TJ Oshie. You never count them out either. Anthony Mantha getting healthy. Them going 7-2-1 since they've gotten healthy. I think every single team in the East that's in that playoff picture, it's going to be madness come April, or sorry, June. I'm still thinking about OHL times. It'll be fun to watch. What's the return on that, Dwayne? Anything yet?
Nothing yet, but just that he's going to Pittsburgh. So I'd imagine, again, a team that's looking to have what they have left in Sid. And I'm no disrespect to Sidney Crosby or Evgeny Malkin, but really to try and take advantage of what might be left in the tank for both those guys together. You know, that's obviously a deal to get to for one last push. But if it doesn't work out in the playoffs for them this year, and they don't have much success, you know, are they going to start to blow things up there in Pittsburgh?
Hey, I have to share something. Blake Coleman, you know, when they do these trade announcements, right?
Yeah. Yeah. They put Nick Paul's face on Blake Coleman's body. Blake Coleman quote tweet is like, that body looks oddly familiar.
Oh, that's great. Oh,
depends.
I love it.
The Ducks are getting a prospect not named yet and a second round pick.
That's for a good Raquel. One.
That's a pretty decent price, to be honest. I thought Raquel would fetch a first, but
we'll see who the prospect is. I don't know who Pittsburgh has in their pool. I'm not really up to date.
They got a pretty thin farm system, obviously, from trading a lot of picks. But
so, you know, props to, what is it, Burke and Hextall over there?
In Pittsburgh, yeah. I mean, that's good. That's a really good pickup. That's a really, really good pickup. And Anaheim just, you know, gets a little bit more to build
just
the future.
It just showed up on my trade tracker. Ricard Raquel to Pittsburgh. Anaheim Ducks. Prospect. Draft pick.
Nice. Yeah. I wonder who the prospect is for sure, but that'll determine
literally
a little more.
Literally, it's Trevor Zegras. Not from Pittsburgh. I'm sorry.
I'm not sure. I was
trying to make a bad joke. Something about the Carolina Hurricanes. Hold on. Hearing that the Carolina Hurricanes made a late push for Max Domi at the deadline, not sure if they got the deal done or not under the wire. That is from Adam Portsline out of Columbus. So
interesting.
Hearing that talk between the Columbus could be on the move. This was 2 minutes ago. I mean, I would love Max Domi in Buffalo, man. He'd be a phenomenal addition.
I'll tell you what, I hated playing against him when he was at the London Knights. He's a pesky son of a bitch that can also, you know, score in different ways. You know, a valuable piece at the right price. And if he fits in with the right group. Yeah. But, you know, like I said, Dwayne, like, it's going to be fun to do this in a year or two down the line if we stay the course and continue to develop our pieces because, you know, for Sabres fans watching that are disappointed, yeah, I get it. We've been through hell for 11 years.
Chicago and Calgary talking Ryan Carpenter as the deadline hit. So, I mean, there's another possibility there.
I will say just before we kind of take a break before coming back at 5 to revisit the day, I will say that, yeah, I mean, obviously I'm biased. I also disagree with Biz saying that Washington's not a real contender. I don't know if people know this, but yeah, a ton of their upper echelon guys were hurt for majority of the year, most notably Mantha. And of course, TJ Oshie has been in and out of the lineup as well. They are now 8th overall in goals against. Like, their defense, which was really terrible at the start of the year, has come alive. Their power play has gotten a lot better this month. They were ticking along at 3rd for the month of March so far. Like, their power play is starting to come back around, which is good news. Yes, there's questions in net, but I would say the same thing about Pittsburgh. I would say the same thing, as well as he's played this year, about Carolina. I would say, you know, I would say the same thing about Boston. How is Boston's goaltending better than Washington's? Swayman's been really good, and Ullmark has played well too. How are they better than Vanecek, Samsonov? I don't think so.
No.
And I hope that the Caps, selfishly as a fan of that team, I hope they read these quotes. I hope they read these and they get the old chip back on the shoulder. Ovi's done. Maybe. Ovi's done. Backstrom's too old. This and that.
Ovi's not done until he's dead.
Yeah. The Russian machine never breaks. Don't forget it. I will say this. They have the best record against the Metropolitan Division of all the teams in that division. They're the team that beats all of the other divisional teams. I believe their record against the Metro this year sits at 13-1-5. They have the best record against their own division of any of those teams. So
crazy.
Count Washington out at your peril. Don't poke the bear.
Don't shoot the messenger. I was just
No. Hey, that's an opinion. Biz can think what he likes. Just
Biz can careful have opinions.
Careful about the bear that you poke. You might
keep
poke
in mind we're talking about a Leafs fan here too. So
yeah, he tweeted out what he tweeted out the other day that enjoy this win while you can. Sabres fans, get those tee times ready. And I posted a screenshot of his playoff stats, 4 games played and no points and 15 penalty minutes. And it's like, Biz, I think you spent more time in the penalty box than you did on the ice during the playoffs. So please tell us all about your vast knowledge of playoff hockey.
My favorite part about that, Dwayne, and it was a good chirp. I'm not gonna lie. It was just some random blue check mark came back at you with some stupid response. And I don't even know the guy's name. I don't know how he's verified. I don't know. You might know who I'm talking about.
I'd have to look. Hold on.
It was just the most mundane. I don't even know. It was just so stupid. Like, you're going to have to find it, dude. And share.
Carolina getting Max Domi. Deal went through.
Wow.
Okay. There you go.
So there they are. There's their move into the arms race. That's a significant addition for them. You know, a guy that's really had a real down spell in his career. Like, you know, he has not lived up to that early hype in Montreal alongside guys, obviously, like Galchenyuk. You know, Montreal thought that those two guys were going to be a big part of them. Yeah.
I play with Galley and Yakupov, two guys
right.
That never really lived up to the hype in Sarnia. I always knew Galley would be better than Yaki. I would have thought he would have found his stride by now. So
certainly
disappointing.
Yeah.
But there, you know, you go back to that class and you know, Domi's right there and been traded a couple times and you know, looking for him to really break through. Maybe this is the place, right? Carolina's had that effect on some players that have come in and you know, hopefully they can do it. I don't know if it was mentioned. I think Dwayne, did you talk about Kotkaniemi getting an 8-year extension?
That did pass in my mentions. I haven't gotten to it yet.
So yeah, Kotkaniemi signing eight years in Carolina. So yeah, There it shows up there. Max Domi for TBA. Mm-hmm. Gotta love the to be not even to be determined. What does TBA stand for?
To be announced, probably.
Be announced. Yeah. There you go. All right. I'm gonna head off the show. You guys take it home from here. Gotta get the salad chop finally. I should have to pay a fine for that. But my appointment's coming up here in about 15 minutes. So appreciate you having me on, Ryan. It was great connecting with you.
You too, bud.
All the best to Guelph this year. Miss my time up there.
Per John Vogel, no trades for the Buffalo Sabres today, so they're done.
Okay.
No surprise there. Does Windsor come to town at all for the rest of the season?
I think we've got one more home game against Windsor.
If Bella or any of the old radio staff or any of those old guys are there from the TV crew, tell them Cully says hello.
Will do.
Good luck to you in the storm. It was great chatting with you, Dwayne, as always. Good luck the rest of the day, my friend.
All right. Thanks for coming on your own show today, Cully. I don't know why you thanked me about having you on, but it's your show too. So there's that.
He's being a nice guy, you know?
I'm just trying to be just a good guy and good guy.
Good to chat with you, buddy. Good to chat with you.
For all the fans listening, thanks for tuning in to Goalies One Mike. I'm Kid Cully. I'm out of here. Go Sabres.
Go Sabres. Yeah. And obviously, real quick reaction to that. We already kind of reacted to that, but Sabres announced that they are done for the day. Not that they even really got started. I'm sure they fielded a lot of calls today, but you know, I guess nothing worth getting done for Kevin Adams. Maybe it is not wanting to break apart the locker room. I'm not too sure, but Buffalo Sabres are done per John Vogel with The Athletic.
I would just assume, like we were saying before, that I think that they're sitting on the pieces they have and thinking that they're going to have more value at the draft and in the summer. Yeah.
Yeah. I think I do think if for like a Victor Olofsson, if he is in play, if he has been shopped today, which I would assume that he was, I would guess that would be more of a draft day deal. You know, Sabres have a lot of picks to use on draft day. So we'll see what happens. I would expect them probably to not use all three of those picks. And it's, you know, we'll see where Vegas ends up in the standings. They're dealing with a lot of injuries. You know, I still don't think Jack Eichel is at 100%. How could you be after taking a year off with a herniated disc in your neck and having ADR replacement surgery? And then obviously you're losing Pacioretty, you lost Stone. I don't think Alec Martinez is back. You don't have a legit starting goalie. That's something that they did not address today was starting goaltending. They're kind of sitting pat with what they have in Laurent Brossoit. And I think, what is it? Luke Thompson? Is it
Zach Thompson? Yeah. Zach
Thompson. Yes. The rookie goaltender. So I don't know. I mean, I don't know. Hopefully that pick, you know, I mean, I love to see them not make the playoffs and I know it's top 10 protected, but maybe it falls to a 11th, 12th, 13th pick, and maybe you just deal, the pick you got from, I believe it was the Florida Panthers, which will probably be outside of the top 25. So I don't expect them to use all three of those first round picks, Ryan.
I don't either. I'd be surprised if they didn't move at least one, potentially two, depending where that Vegas pick falls. They'll keep their own, I would think. Unless somebody, you know, approaches them with something that floors them where they really think they can add a long-term piece, particularly on the blue line, that will help them going forward in bringing along Dahlin and eventually Owen Power to that next level. Yeah, I think the Sabres phone lines are going to be one of the most active at the draft.
I agree. You know, if Buffalo falls outside of the top five, I know, like, you know, it kind of gets a little hairy. You would know more than me, I guess, in terms of what is available after Shane Wright and Cooley. You know, are there picks worth where they might fall outside of the top five? Or should Kevin Adams, you know, entertain possibly trading either back in the draft out of the top five or, you know, trading the pick altogether to get back to get a player with term and, you know, that, you know, could play in your top six.
It would depend on where they fall and what they want. And if they're going to try and target a defenseman and they fall out of the top five, they might just move back because there are defensemen that are available later. I mean, the number one rated defenseman, obviously, is Pavel Minchikov. Really, really talented player out of Saginaw. I've seen a bunch of his games this year. He'll be a difference maker in the NHL. Puck mover, very confident, really good skater. Number one power play unit. He can do a little bit of everything out there. It's going to be pretty center heavy at the top of the draft. I mean, after you get past Wright and Cooley and Matt Savoy and Connor Geeky, Minchikov falls there at five on central scouting. And then you're starting to see, you know, Denton Matichuk, I think, is a guy that I don't necessarily know that Buffalo would have interest in, a defenseman like that, a smaller guy. Tristan Luno out of Gatineau would probably be more up their alley. Maybe a guy, you know, if you move back and you look at the 15th overall ranked guy out of Drummondville, obviously Maverick Lamoureux is a really, really big kid, 6'7", 196, but moves well out there. Maybe they're starting to, you know, consider targeting a guy like that. They are going to have options here. I mean, because no matter where they fall, they're and if they stay there, like, there's good options here for them. Snuggerud is going to be a good winger. Jack Hughes, not the New Jersey one, he's going to be available. Luca Del Belbelu is having an unbelievable season with Mississauga. He's going to be available. Do they like a guy like Adam Ingram or Matias Sapovalov? There's going to be talented guys. I know that there's names out there that are not well known because of obviously guys missing years because of COVID. There's going to be talent there for the Buffalo Sabres to grab if they keep the picks. And there's going to be talent that other teams want with those picks if they choose to move them and shore up, I'm sure, their decor, which would be priority number one for them.
Correct. Yeah. Kevin Adams due to meet with the media at 3:45. So in about 25 minutes. So, I mean, Ryan, again, you said you'll join us at 5 o'clock. With
sure thing.
Tree. Appreciate that. We'll do some post deadline roundup, wrap up, you know, another quick episode, but thanks for hopping on with us, dude. I appreciate it. Everybody, this has been episode 92 of Two Goalies, One Mic, Trade Deadline Edition. No trades for the Sabres today. Robert Hagel left yesterday for a sixth-round pick to the Florida Panthers. Big deals of today were obviously guys like Max Domi, Marc-Andre Fleury, Lakanen, amongst others. Andrew Kopp, they're still working on the return for that. It seems to be picks and a prospect. Tyler Mott, you know, the list goes on and on. But again, Ryan, thank you for hopping on with us now. And thank you for hopping on with us for a short time at around 5 p.m.
You bet, bud. Thanks for having me.
Not a problem, man. This has been episode 92 of Two Goalies, One Mic. We are signing off. We will join you in about an hour and a half once again.